quarterback Noah Brindise has come off the bench the last two games to spark a struggling Florida offense, leading the Gators to victory on the road at Auburn and two second-half touchdowns against the Georgia Bulldogs. Today, Brindise gets his first career start to try to get the Gators back on track on homecoming Saturday at the University of Florida. A great day for Gator alums throughout the Southeast to return to the alma mater, and they hope to see a return to greatness for this Florida Gator football team. From Ben Hill Griffin Stadium at Florida Field on the campus of the University of Florida in Gainesville, Sunshine Network presents Florida Gator football today. It's the Vanderbilt Commodores in town to take on the Florida Gators. Hello, everyone, and now I know what it's like to get kicked upstairs. Larry Battelle with you in the broadcast booth, along with Matt Moore. We welcome you to our coverage of Florida Vanderbilt, and that for this Gator football team. What an adjustment. They've lost two games in the first 8 weeks, and they've not done it in 5 years. What do they got to do to deal with it?
Well, Larry, that is true. That's very different. But the key point this week in practice, the coaches have been stressing getting back to having fun. What they have not been doing is having fun. They've been trying to make the corrections, and when we look at the graphics, we see offensively that they have not done a good job of pass protection. The quarterback has not done a good job of reading and going to the right guy, and the receivers have not been able to hang on to the football.
Well, if you don't throw it, you don't catch it, you don't block, there's no fun in the fun and guns. To get that back, they've got to play well today against a very good Vanderbilt defense, keyed by three outstanding linebackers.
Well, they've got three great linebackers,
but the main two, Carlton Hall, number 34, is the leading tackler on this Vanderbilt football team, but the guy that makes it happen is number 49, Jamie Duncan. And whenever there's a big play, expect to see Jamie Duncan around the football.
Jamie Duncan, a fifth-year senior for the Vanderbilt Commodores. He's out of Delaware. The big schools didn't want him. They'd love to have him right now, and the Gators wish somebody else had him a year ago today, because it was against Vanderbilt in Nashville last year when Duncan had a field day, including this sack of Danny Werfel, which he then picked up and ran in for a touchdown. That put Vanderbilt back in the game and led the Commodores to a near upset of the Florida Gators on the Gators' way to a national championship. And great defenses of Vandy hallmark again this year.
Without a doubt, that's the key to this Vandy football team, and Woody Woodenhofer is the secret. You know, he's a great defensive coordinator that just does a super job of getting his team ready to play.
Think about Woody. He was the defensive coordinator for the steel curtain in the mid-70s. Now Woody Woodenhofer, the head coach of the Vanderbilt Commodores. The Gator defense has a whole other situation to deal with. Vandy runs an option offense, which means your linebackers have to make a lot of plays, but which linebackers do they have? For more on that, let's go down to the field and Steve Babbitt.
Thanks, Larry. That's true. In addition to nursing some bruised egos, they're trying to nurse back some linebackers to help. They didn't have Keith Kelsey available at Georgia. In that first half, they lost Mike Peterson and Dwayne Thomas, and Johnny Rutledge played sick. So against Vanderbilt today, they have Johnny Rutledge back. Two guys playing hurt, Dwayne Thomas and Mike Peterson. No Keith Kelsey. Don't be surprised if at one time during the defensive set, you see a lineup of Javon Kirst on the outside, Teddy Sims on the outside, and Johnny Rutledge in the middle. It's gotten to that point. Let's go back up to Larry.
All right, Steve, we've got a packed house again here at the Swamp for homecoming. Florida and Vanderbilt next on Sunshine.
Florida Gator football on Sunshine Network is brought to you by First Union. When it comes to service, everything matters. Great Southern Wood, makers of Osmos pressure-treated pine. If it doesn't say Osmos on the yellow tag, you don't want it. Dairy Farmers, got milk? Buy the new Dodge, from cars to minivans to trucks, it's about change. The new Dodge. And by Shands Healthcare, improving health one person at a time.
You missed the train, Pop.
Don't know why I'm even going. I never sold these guys anything.
Take this.
I can live without that. If I could take you through some recent competitive history.
We don't need history. We need news.
New AT&T Digital PCS. Digital clarity, voicemail, even messaging all in one.
Funny you should say that.
Welcome to life on the world's most powerful network.
Fellas, tonight we have with us a real winner.
Right on, Buzz, from Great Southern Wood.
That's right, that's right. I would have a lifetime guarantee, and it comes to you clean and straight. But that's our honored guest, Steve Spurrier. Steve doesn't know this yet, but Coach, we voted you in. Let's give him the official welcome.
Hello, Steve!
So remember, if it doesn't say Osmos on the yellow tag, believe me, you don't want it.
My
my wife will like this.
I'm sorry, sir, but we're closing.
Yeah, but I just wanted to know...
Why shop around someone else's schedule? With complete 24-hour service, GEICO lets you buy car insurance anytime. Buy directly over the phone and you could save 15% or more. GEICO Direct, a better way to buy car insurance.
Does this come in beige?
The Internet. Billions of miles of cable connecting employers with some of the best and brightest minds in the country. The students and alumni of the SEC Career Center. To advertise your full-time, part-time, or internship opportunities, contact your SEC Career Center or call JobTrack. 800-999-TRACK.
Florida and Florida State look to settle their differences at the 6th Annual Melt Challenge Basketball Classic, Sunday, December 14th. Call 407-839-3900 for ticket information. The battle lines have been drawn. Will the bravery of the Seminoles prevail, or will the Gators' charm lead to a victory? Melt Challenge is presented by the Dairy Farmers. Tickets available at Orlando Arena or by calling Ticketmaster at 407-839-3900.
Hi, I'm Chris Thorne. You're watching Breakfast with the Gators on Sunshine Network.
The Florida Gators take to the field on an absolutely gorgeous day in the University City. The Gators trying to bounce back from the loss to Georgia and keep their winning ways going here in the swamp on Sunshine Network. Florida at 6-2. The Gators still in a position to do a couple of things that are very important to this program. Obviously a quality bowl bid, but also a chance to remain one of three teams in the country to win 9 games each year in the 90s. Florida has to win 3 more, including a possible bowl game, in order to reach that level. And amazingly enough, they're not totally out of the SEC race, although with 2 losses, it's going to be awfully difficult for the Gators. They're going to need a great deal of help, but they're still in, at least peripheral in that. They're in that picture a little bit.
Well, Larry, they're in it, but realistically, when you think of all the things that's got to happen, last year we were very fortunate after losing to Florida State that things happened to put us back into the national picture, but with Georgia and Tennessee being ahead of the Gators, it's going to be real tough, and it's situations the Gators are not used to where they don't control their own destiny.
Bobby Stoops, the Gator defensive coordinator, saw his unit give up 37 points last week against Georgia. They certainly want to be more aggressive and more effective today. The series history for Florida, they lead the Vanderbilt Commodore series. In fact, Vandy with just 1 win in Gainesville, and it was in 1945. The first time Florida Vanderbilt met was here in Gainesville. Vanderbilt won that one. They have not won a ball game in Gainesville since then. For head coach Steve Spurrier, this is his second chance to try to close in on a milestone victory during his head coaching career on the college level. The Gator head man with 79 victories as coach of the Gators in the 90s has 99 coaching victories between Florida and Duke. So milestone number 100, it would be sweet to get that right here in the swamp.
Well, it would be a good thing for both Steve Spurrier and the Gator fans to see the Gators get back on track. You would expect for him to already have 101, but it just has not happened that way this year with, you know, some of the shortcomings of the offensive woes that we showed in the opening of the show. Telecast, excuse me.
You see the Gators warming up over there. Florida will start off defensively. The Gators won the toss and deferred until the second half. So they will put their kickoff unit on the field and they will put their defense on the field. And we would be underway if we could have gotten the alarm to go off in the Commodore locker room, because, well, they got their trainers and their managers. That's a start. We're still waiting for the football team. The Gator kickoff unit's on the field, and here come the Vanderbilt Commodores of the SEC. Vanderbilt 0-5 in conference action this year, and their offense has been completely inept in SEC play. The most points they've scored in any league game, 13 points. They're averaging only 5 points a game against Southeastern Conference competition. Beautiful day here in the University City. It is November. It has cooled off, 56 degrees, and it will warm gradually into the low to mid 60s throughout the course of this afternoon's action. just a light breeze, should not be much of a factor as far as the kicking game is concerned, and no threat of rain. So for this homecoming weekend, the alums get a great one. But this football team really needs some success. I think offensively, they need some early success just to feel good about themselves.
And that's what we're used to seeing the offense dominate early on, and then the defense being able to key in and come after the quarterback, knowing that the opponent has to play from behind. But recently, that has not happened. You know, the defense is put in a situation where the opponent's offense can throw anything at them because you're not sure what they're going to do, because they're controlling the ball game at that time. Sir.
Woody Woodenhofer was the head coach of the Missouri Tigers in the 80s, came to Vanderbilt as the defensive coordinator a couple years ago, and now in his first year as head coach at Vanderbilt. And while teams lately have played a soft zone to have success against the Florida offense, that soft zone phrase does not apply to Woody Woodenhofer. They will be aggressive. Robbie Stevenson kicks off, good driving kick, and it will go out of the end zone without a touch from Alvin Duke, the scheduled return man for the Vanderbilt Commodores. So the Commodores will go on offense to start today's ball game at the 20-yard line against a Florida defense that features Moten and McGrew at the tackles, Willie Rogers and Willie Cohen, the defensive end, as the Florida defensive front tries to give Vanderbilt the willies. A linebacking core, Rutledge Thomas Kearse, scheduled to be in there. Look for also Teddy Sims, number 39, to see a lot of playing time. And in the secondary, Fred Weary still looking for that record-breaking interception. Damian Allen at quarterback for Vanderbilt. They run inside, nothing there. The runner is upended by Mike Moten. And it'll be a loss of a couple as the senior knifed in there and disrupted the play right away.
Just a great job of penetration by Mike Moten, getting very low, getting inside, and is able to upend the McGrath before he's able to get back into the hole. He tried to cut back.
Damian Allen, the quarterback for Vandy, much improved as a passer this year, only four interceptions, hitting about 50%, a little below that. Faced with second and long back at the 17-yard line. They'll run a draw, big hole closes quickly. McGrew got the first hand on Jared McGrath, and then Teddy Sims helped finish it off, a gain of about three or four. It'll be third and long. Offensively for Vandy, McGrath is a freshman. He's from Ocala Forest, just about 35 miles away. Asma, Yoder, the receivers, but their top receiver, Tavares Hogan's number seven, does not start. The offensive line is where they've had trouble giving protection for Damian Allen and running room for those tailbacks. We'll see what kind of success that O-line has against the Gators today. Third down, three wide to the right. Now McGrath comes in motion. It's a quarterback draw. Allen's got five. He's got a first down up to about the 32-yard line. Ted Sims, Chico Brown get in on the tackle, but the quarterback draw works for the Commodores, and it's a first down at the 32.
And what we get here, he handles the snap, but this is a quarterback draw all the way. They don't want to take a chance on Damian Allen doing anything crazy to give the Gators good field position by turning the ball over, so they played it close to the vest and was fortunate enough to pick up the first down.
Damian Allen has gained over 300 yards as a runner this year. He's also lost close to 200 as a quarterback getting sacked. They run inside again. There's just nothing there. Florida dominating the middle. That time, Javon Kearse, Johnny Rutledge blows it up in a hurry, and virtually no gain for Vanderbilt.
A good look at Teddy Sims, freshman out of Belgrade, getting some playing time.
Teddy Sims and Johnny Rutledge were high school teammates at Glade Central High School in Belgrade 3 years ago. Rutledge now a junior with the Gators. Sims a redshirt freshman. On second down, long count for Damian Allen. Gets the playoff. Here's the pressure. He gets a swing pass. Open field there. And a good pickup and close to another first down for the Vanderbilt Commodores. Jimmy Williams, another freshman for Vandy, run out of bounds at the 44, so he picks up a dozen and a Vanderbilt first down.
And I tell you, Larry, Jimmy Williams is a good one. Not only does he lead this team in rushing with a 5.1 yard per average, but he also leads the team in receiving, as you see Damian Allen throwing it out to him in the flat, and Eli Williams takes the wrong pursuit angle, and Williams is able to outrun him to get the first down.
Consecutive first downs for the Commodores on the initial possession of this ball game has quieted the homecoming crowd in the swamp. First look at the option, pitch to the outside. There's Williams again, and he gets about four or five before Tico Brown spins him out of bounds. Tico with 28 tackles on this season for Florida from his free safety spot. In a secondary also hurting a little bit today. Mike Harris, who's played a lot of football, especially in the Georgia game, where he was in on more than 10 tackles, injured his shoulder against Georgia. We do not expect to see Mud Harris in the contest this afternoon. On second and a long five, Allen looks to throw. Under pressure, gets it off way high. He tried to throw it to Todd Yoder, but it sailed over Yoder and Fred Weary and falls incomplete.
Well, he was forced to throw this ball to Todd Yoder, but he really wanted to go out in the flat to Jimmy Williams, but Johnny Rutledge did a good job of coming up and forcing him to try and throw the ball to his outlet. That time, the split receiver was the outlet where they really wanted to go in the flat, Larry.
Vanderbilt had success with a pass in the flat, and Florida takes it away on that second down play, and it's another third down situation for Vanderbilt. On the draw, open running room, Williams gets close to the first down and then is driven back, and he'll be a yard shy. Teddy Sims in on his third tackle in this opening possession, stops Vanderbilt about a yard to a yard and a half shy of first down yardage. And Vandy is just doing a great job of mixing up their play calling. It's here, third five, and they run the football. They give it to their favorite running back, Jimmy Williams, and he comes up a yard shy as Teddy Sims comes in and puts the stop on him. Joe Webb will punt for Vanderbilt. Webb is a freshman, doesn't get a lot of long kicks, but he gets plenty of hang time. Not near the top of the SEC in the gross punting stats, but their net punting is excellent. He has a little double clutch, and then he kicks it off the side of his foot. Hits at the 25, rolls out of bounds at the 15-yard line, and that's where the Gators will go on offense. First and 10 at their own 15. I tell you, Webb might have been able to run for about 20 yards if he decided not to kick it. Look at the room in front of him.
Well, I guess that's the good thing, because as he goes to mishandle his snap, and then he said, oh, no, I better kick it. You know, he had some room out front, and they're laughing at him as he talked to Woody Woodenhofer, the head coach.
We'll be back with Florida's first possession right after this. Gator coach Steve Spurrier trying to get the fun back in the fun and gun this week as the Gator offense has struggled, as we touched on at the top of our telecast. Florida, the last 3 weeks, only two touchdown passes, one of those thrown by Jacquez Green, the other thrown by Noah Brindise. See the numbers on Noah this season, 44% completion, three touchdowns, only one interception. He's out of Cypress Lake High School in Fort Myers. Spent a year at a small college in North Carolina, Wingate, then transferred to Florida. Wasn't even certain he was going to come out for the football team. Just thought he'd get a good education at the University of Florida. Decided to come out and eventually earned a scholarship, and now gets his first start here in the Swamp.
And you have to be happy for the young man, a fifth-year senior that has paid his dues and now being given the opportunity to try and lead this Gators football team.
Florida comes out. Also got Taurus Ross making his first start of the season at tight end. Gators run inside. Not much there for Fred Taylor. Got a yard, maybe two. A host of Vanderbilt tacklers there, as Florida's first play does not go all that far. Offensively for the Florida Gators this afternoon, Rod Frazier, the freshman fullback, trying to find some running room for Fred Taylor. Travis McGriff back in the Florida starting lineup, along with Jacquez Green. We mentioned Taurus Ross in the offensive line. This is the way they finished against Georgia. Collins, Kalick, Rich, Blackshear, and Tiller from left to right. On second and nine, the Gators run a reverse. Plenty of running room, but it disappears in a hurry, and Jacquez Green is down at the 22-yard line. Ainsley battles the strong safety, stayed home and made the play, and creates a third and three for the Gator offense. So the Gators try and strike early with a little trickery as they bring Jacquez back to the left side on a reverse. Good blocking out front. And here Jacquez tries to cut back, but a good tackle by Ainsley Battle, not allowing him to cut back against the grain. So it's third down for this Florida offense. They must get the nose of the ball across the 25-yard line. Vanderbilt picked up a pair of first downs on their initial possession before the Gators forced a punt. Back to throw, Brindise under pressure, down he goes. The blitz was there, and Carlton Hall, one of those two superb linebackers we told you about, picked up his 94th tackle, tops in the SEC, and the Gators will go three and out offensively. Well, Larry, that's deja vu. As we saw last year, it was Jamie Duncan. This time it's Carlton Hall, number 34, and they showed the blitz all the way. You know, Brindise had a chance and had plenty of time to check out and try and get into the proper blocking scheme, but they weren't able to do it. I believe Fred Taylor picked up Jamie Duncan. You saw Fred run in on the left side. He picked up Duncan. Hall came clean. Now Robbie Stevenson, the punt for Florida. That's a good punt coming down to the 43-yard line. Duke gets away from the first man, can't get away from the rest of them. Tony George was the first guy there. John Exnidus made the tackle. 47 yards on the Robbie Stevenson punt, just a 2-yard return, but Vanderbilt has outstanding field position as they go to work just across the 46-yard line. Commodores have really struggled offensively. It's a young offensive team, only Anthony Asma, Damian Allen, seniors in that starting lineup. They'll need to be a lot better next year because six of their top seven defenders are seniors. Two receivers slid wide to the left. One comes in motion. That's Hogan. Under pressure, Kirst chases out. He throws it up for grabs. It'll go way out of bounds. Devon Kirst with the pressure. Good coverage by Eli Williams on Tavares Hogan. Well, play action pass, and Javon Kirst does a good job of not being fooled. Gets good pressure on Damian Allen, but Damian Allen shows you the leadership there as he throws the ball high and wide outside, making sure that he avoids the sack. Willie Rogers favoring his right leg, it appeared, when he went down and is getting attention from the Florida medical staff. The senior from Hialeah. Willie with four quarterback sacks this season, also has eight pressures of the quarterback, has broken up three passes, had a very solid year at that left end spot for Florida. And I tell you, Larry, if we really want to talk about what has happened to this Gator defense, here's a perfect indication. This is another injury. You got Willie Rogers, who's been playing superbly, and now he's down. And with the injuries that we've had to the linebacking core, the defensive line during the series of the early part of this year, it's amazing that the defense has been able to play at the level they have been. Mike Wasik, Steven Delicato, among those tending to Willie Rogers. We'll check on his status with Steve Babick momentarily, but for now, the Gators have a second and 10 defensively against this Vandy offense. Tim Beauchamp, the junior from New Smyrna Beach, has checked in at that left end spot. Vanderbilt with wide receivers each direction. Went a little delay with McGrath. He runs right into the teeth of the Florida defense, led by Reggie McGrew. Johnny Rutledge gets in on the play, and there's a loss of a yard. It's third and long. Well, that was just an excellent play by Reggie McGrew of fighting off the blocker and closing down the hole, allowing Johnny Rutledge to step up and make the tackle. Just he gets double teamed, but he would not be blocked. He fights through the double team, seals the hole, and Johnny Rutledge comes up and makes the tackle. Just great play by your defensive tackle. Rutledge, a semifinalist for the Butkus Award, the top linebacker in the country. On third and long, Chester puts the pressure on. Allen throws it, picked off. Fred Weary's got it. Weary across midfield. Weary inside the 35-yard line, and he'll be dropped right there, but Fred Weary from Mandarin High School, a fifth-year senior, makes a 26-yard interception return, and he now is the all-time leading interceptor in Florida Gator football history.
And this is all Fred Weary, Larry, because he does a great job of sitting back, reading the quarterback eyes, and then reacting up. When he picks this ball up, this is not intended for his man. He comes off his man and makes the play, and then just does a super job of running with the football after the catch. You know, what would it have been like to say, when I broke the record, I ran it back for a touchdown? You see him trying to get an end zone.
Florida comes out in the Emery and Henry formation from the 33-yard line. Brindise pumps, gets rid of it. There's Taylor.
Brett inside the 25, gets away from the tackle. Taylor to the 15, Taylor down to the 12-yard line.
Let's give Brett Taylor a lot of credit because, you know, they come out in this crazy spread offense. What do you call it? Emory and Henry. But he does a super job of getting outside, giving Noah Brindise somewhere to throw the football. And if he doesn't run into his own guy, he's liable to score here. But a super job on Fred Taylor's part of giving the quarterback something to throw to.
Bo Carroll's checked into the ball game. He's flat on the left side. Carroll, the second man on the reverse. Trey Green has the ball. Trey Green's got 5-6 yards down to the 6-yard line. Ryan Alds, the nose tackle, makes the stop for Vandy. But the Gators pulling out all stops to jumpstart this offense, have a drive going.
Well, normally you say, if I'm going to run the football, I want to get those big tackles and those big guards out front. But what do? They get Bo Carroll, the smallest man on the offense, out front, leading Jaquez Green on a sweep. You talking about pulling out all the stops. And look at this block. Oh, crushing blow by Bo Carroll as he tries to take off Corey Shaver's head.
Gators fake the reverse. Taylor on the inside got maybe a yard to the 5. Alfonso Harvey, a native Floridian. There are 10 Floridians on this Vanderbilt football team, and Harvey made the stop, and the Gators have a third down. They can get a first down if they get the ball inside the 2-yard line. Inside the 20, the Gators 10 times have been kept without a touchdown, 7 times without scoring. That's an unusually high number for this offense.
Extremely high for this Gator football team because they're noted to put the ball into the end zone.
Gators a little confusion on the substitution. 5 seconds on the play clock. Rod Frazier picks up the man. He's got a block on third down. Brindise went inside, still on his... Well, they tried to do a little sneak play inside with Rod Frazier. He was lined up as if to pick up Duncan, then they hand him the ball, and he picked up Duncan anyway.
Well, to be honest, I don't think Rod Frazier knew what was going on because he started out of the huddle off the field, and they sent him back in. And he stepped up as if he was going to pick up the blitzer, and all of a sudden he had the football in his midsection.
It's 4th and 2 from the 4-yard line, and Steve Spurrier wants some points. So Collins Cooper, who's made 4 out of 6 field goals this season, will try to make number 5 on the year. And the junior from Jacksonville Episcopal High School delivers the 3 for the Gators. And Florida is on the board, 5:35 to play. Opening period in the swamp. The Gators have the first points of the ball game.
On Sunshine.
A 3-0 early lead for the Florida Gators as they look for win number 7 on the season against the Vanderbilt Commodores, who are 3-5. The Gators getting set to kick off, but first, let's get a report from Steve Babbitt.
For defensive end Willie Rogers, a right knee sprain, maybe not too severe. They're going to take him in the locker room, retape it, and see if he can come back out. Good news was he was able to put pressure on it. I think they want to stabilize it and make sure it's proper before he goes back out. Boy, it's been a tough year for injuries. Early in the 90s, the Gators had no depth, no injuries. Now they have all their depth, but a lot of injuries in the last couple of years.
Particularly defensively this year for Florida. Last year down the stretch, Nat, it was all offensive linemen. It seemed like every injury was an offensive lineman.
And to their credit, they had enough quality offensive linemen that they were able to plug them in and do a good job. Jimmy Ray Stevens doing a super job as offensive line coach, and now we're stuck with the same thing with Coach Rod Broadway trying to juggle his defensive line.
Stevenson kicks off, Damian Charlie and Alvin Duke deep. It'll be Duke at the 2-yard line. Alvin Duke looking for running room right side, doesn't find much, gets up to about the 24-yard line. Teddy Sims, Taurus Ross in on the tackle. Taurus Ross leads the Gators with 13 special team tackles. Here's that play again, if you can figure it out.
Well, I look like Rod Frazier knew what was going on, but the defense was not fooled. As you see, Jamie Duncan right there on the play, calling the Gators a quick play, trying to get Rod Frazier into the end zone.
Winkler checks in as one receiver. Asma the other for Vanderbilt on first down at the 24. Jumping around, the Gators were offside. Allen ended up having to keep it. He lost a couple, but Buck Gurley in at the left tackle spot. Looked like he got a head start into the neutral zone, and Vandy will have a 1st and 5.
Well, that's called early anticipation.
Gators this year much better as far as penalties are concerned. They scaled back dramatically from the penalties of past years.
Offsides on the defense, 5-yard penalty from the previous spot, repeat first down.
They've been able to scale back, but in crucial situations, they've been able to get fooled with the hard count. As we take a look there, it's Buck Curley going on the hard count, guessing on the snap count. You can't do that. You got to wait to see the ball move. You go on ball movement. Two injured linebackers in for the Gators, Mike Peterson and Dwayne Thomas. We'll keep an eye on them, see how effective they are and how healthy. They've been cleared to play, and they want to play. Up the inside, that's Jared McGrath from Ocala. Not much running room. Tim Beauchamp got a hand on him, as did Ed Chester, Dwayne Thomas, all involved in the play. Just nothing fancy, just coming off the football, giving the ball to McGrath as he tries to leap over, and you see Tony George coming in to put the finishing touches. But, you know, one of the problems you run into when you start to play injured players is their mobility and their ability to fight off blockers and get into the play. And that's what we need to look at with Peters and Thomas.
Oh, they run a slow developing draw play, and Willie Cohen says, not in my house. And the junior from Stark Bradford County drops it for about a 4-yard loss.
Just great penetration by Willie Cohen as he fights off the fullback, Morgan, and then comes right in, and there's just nowhere for Jared McGrath to run with the football.
Willie Cohen, very active in the Georgia game. Seemed to play his best game as a Gator this season over in Jacksonville a week ago. Now it's third down, and they need five after having second and one. Allen ranging to his left. No one to throw it to. The Gator defense misses him. He's able to turn it into a positive play, but not a first down. Buck Gurley ends up making the tackle, but it was Cohen's and Rutledge that had a chance to drop him for a big loss.
Well, I tell you this, that was a good defensive stand by the Gators, but Damian Allen had some quicks. When the Gators thought they had him pinned back, he decided to cut back, and once he decided to accelerate, he was through that hole in a hurry, Larry.
We'll get our second look at Vanderbilt punter Joe Webb. His first effort was a wobbler. You may remember he double-clutched on it. If the Gators stay home this time, make sure he kicks it. They do. It was a driving kick. Backing up, Josh Quest, Green to the 19-yard line. Quest starts up the middle. Looks for running room. Can't find a lot. And he'll take it back to the 31-yard line. A 51-yard kick. Give him a dozen on the return. And put the ball at the 31-yard line, where the Gators will have it first and 10. With their third offensive possession of this ball game. We've got a timeout on the field here at Ben Hill Griffin Stadium, Florida Field. The Gators up 3 with the football when we return.
Temperature might be dropping.
The Florida Gators lead it 3-0 as Willie Rogers gets himself ready to get back into this ballgame. 3 minutes to go in the opening quarter here at Florida Field. The Gator volleyball team will host SEC rival Georgia Friday, November 14th at 7 o'clock in the O'Connell Center. We invite you to come out for Sunshine Network Night. The first 500 fans will receive Gator volleyball training card sets courtesy of Sunshine Network. There'll probably be about 2,000 people there, so get there early if you want your Gator volleyball trading cards from Sunshine Network on Friday night, November 14th. The Vanderbilt defense has only allowed Florida 25 yards so far in this ballgame, and more than half those came on the Emory and Henry pass to Fred Taylor. The Gators begin their third offensive set. There's Taylor looking in the inside. Not much there again as he is driven backwards. Ryan Aul holds ground in the middle along with free safety Raheem Batten. The Vanderbilt defense up front, the ends of the top players, Jay Stallworth and Glenn Young, are outstanding defensive ends. Alls plugs the middle. The linebacking core we touched on earlier, Jordan, Duncan, and Hall, terrific players, particularly Duncan and Hall, who are the top two tacklers in the SEC. And in the secondary, the corners, Corey Chavis and Fred Vincent, a tremendous tandem. People have not thrown in the direction of Corey Chavis very often this year. Second down, they got about 1 yard on their first down play. Now Brindise, plenty of time, throws in the flat all by himself. Trey Green dropped it. And that is just trying to run before you catch the football. He does a good job. He's trying to catch the ball in his hands, and just as he goes to catch it, he doesn't look at it as he's putting it away, and it comes out, Larry. You know, this is just being over-anxious and trying to make a big play.
Jacquez with 99 career receptions. Well, this is wide open. Vincent is worried about the blowout. He stands there deep, and there you see, just as he goes to catch the ball, he takes his eyes off it, and he starts to look upfield, looking to see where the defenders are coming from. Vandy shows blitz on third and nine, but they're not really coming. Brindise with time throws to Travis McGriff. Did he get a foot down? No. Unlike the NFL, if he pushes you out, that's okay. And in the NFL, I think this might have been a completion, but under college rules, not the case. Well, he has a step on Chavis. Goes up, makes a good catch, but he's shoved out by Corey Chavis, using the sideline as his helper. And as you said, Larry, in the NFL, they would have ruled that good, but not in college.
Gee, I wonder how you, a receiver, feel about that rule.
Well, as a receiver, I think that if you have the ability to come down and put an inside the boundaries, it should be a catch. But then again, that's taking something away from the defense, and I'm an offensive guy, so I'm all for offense.
There's Robbie Stevenson, a low kick. This is returnable. Taken by Duke back at the 21-yard line. Goes straight up the field for 12, 13 yards before the Gators get to him. John Exnitis, as usual, on the play, along with Dwayne Thomas. 45 on the kick. Give him a dozen on the return. And it's now Vanderbilt ball once again. If you like Florida Vanderbilt action, you got more of it coming your way at 1 o'clock this afternoon on Sunshine Network. It's the SEC Championship match, Vanderbilt against Florida, at 1 o'clock live on Sunshine Network. Vandy beat Florida earlier this year 2-0. The Gators want revenge and the conference championship, and you'll see right here whether or not they get it. From the 34, Vanderbilt again with excellent field position. Jared McGrath spins off a tackler, goes forward for about 3 or 4 yards. Willie Cohens ends up making the stop for the Gator defense, but it looked like McGrath would get nothing, but he spun his way free and picked up a few.
I think Tony George was the young man that had a hand on him, and he was able to spin out of the tackle, and it took Willie Cohens coming in making the final stop. As you see, a great spin there. Tony George missing the tackle, but Willie Cohens coming in to clean up.
Seen a lot of Jared McGrath early this game for Vanderbilt. Kid back home, has a lot of family and friends, I'm sure, in the stadium. Allen on the option, nowhere to go with it, turns it inside, and he's dropped. McGrew hit him first. Dwayne Thomas finishes him off, no gain, maybe a half yard on the play, that's it.
Well, they come out trying to run the option, but the Gator defensive line is just doing a great job of getting penetration and forcing him to turn back in, as we see Kim Beauchamp break down the blocking scheme, forcing Damian Allen to turn back inside.
And when you play an option team, there should be a stat for that. Tim Beauchamp played his assignment perfectly, doesn't get a tackle or an assist, but did a great job turning it in, as you pointed out.
His teammates know.
And they'll see it in the film session. On third down, under pressure, they've got him. Down he goes. Mike Moulton puts away Damian Allen, and it'll be another punting situation for the Commodore.
Well, Mike Moulton comes down with the sack, but once again, Tim Beauchamp forces the action as he's able to knife inside. If you look at the top of your screen on the left side, you'll see Beauchamp come in and force Damian Allen to come back out to Mike Moulton. Great execution by that Gator defensive line.
And you like to see those games played out that well by defensive linemen when they stunt and twist and such, getting the guy free. Another kick from Webb, not a very good one. Green runs up to make the catch at the 38 and basically falls into the hands of Corey Chavis at the 42-yard line. And that will be the final play in the first quarter of this SEC football matchup between the Florida Gators and the Vanderbilt Commodores. A Gator interception which led to a field goal, the only point in the opening quarter. We'll be back with second quarter action right after this timeout on Sunshine Network. The Swamp, Ben Hill Griffin Stadium, Florida Field on the campus of the University of Florida. Second quarter action on Sunshine Network. The Gators lead 3-0. Opening play of the second quarter. Brindise looking deep. He's got a man. Jacquez Green. Quez has got it inside the 10-yard line. He beat Fred Vinson to the inside, and it's first and goal.
Good adjustment by Jacquez Green, and that's what the great ones do. You drop one, you can't wait for that opportunity to make up. And as he beat Fred Vinson, he actually had him beat by 4 or 5 yards. Ball hung a little bit. Noah Brindise trips going back, throws off the timing. Now he airs it out, and he has him beat by 2 or 3 yards. He has to wait on it, but he goes up, takes the ball away. Just super concentration by Quezzy as he goes up and makes the catch for a big first down.
And a big milestone for Jaquez Green out of Beach County High School in Fort Valley, Georgia. 100 career receptions for the junior. The Gators. Brindise signals a change in the route. The play clock is not running, so the Gators don't know what's going on. And now a late snap. The back judge blew the whistle, and Florida will get a delay of game. But there is no play clock running, so I think Florida may protest this one a little bit. Let's get an update from Steve down on the field.
Thanks, Florida. I'm with James Jones. You know, when they talk about who's going to be quarterback, Noah Brindise, Doug Johnson, Jesse Palmer, you know, a lot of it depends on how the supporting cast does. A good supporting cast makes all quarterbacks look good.
It sure does. As you can see, where Quez Green caught a nice post route from Noah Brindise, but he also dropped a sure first down pass. So no matter who's in there catching the ball or who's in there blocking for him or who's that quarterback, you have to make plays. And that time, Quez made a play.
Let's go back up to Larry.
All right. Thank you very much, Steve and James. Florida now with first and goal at the 14-yard line. Fred Taylor tries to get to the outside, runs over a man, still on his feet down to the 8. The ball comes out, but they'll say he was already down at the 8-yard line. But Fred Vinson has a number 21 plastered on his forehead.
Well, that's just good, tough running. You know, what you try and do when you run the football is get a hat on everybody, and when there's not a hat on the guy, then you've got to take him on, and that's exactly what Fred Taylor did. And of course, Fred Vincent wished someone was blocking, because when they look at the film and see how he got ran over by that Mack truck, they're going to be laughing in the film room.
Water will go with 5 receivers on second and goal. Open on the inside. McGriff can't pull it in. Nice play by Fred Vinson to get up and deflect the pass from Brindise.
Fred Vinson, so this is more like it. This is what I get the big bucks to do. Cover little receivers, not tackle big tailbacks. As McGriff has a step on him, but just as the ball arrives, he does a great job of going up, sticking his hand in there, swatting it away before McGriff can come down with the touchdown catch.
There's Travis McGriff, the junior from right here in Gainesville, TK Young School. Of course, his dad Lee, an outstanding Gator receiver in the 70s. On third and goal, Brindise looks, fires, and it's picked off at the goal line. Oh, they say it's dropped. No interception. Ainsley Battles was there. It looked like Battles picked it off, but the officials wave it off, say incomplete, and the Gators will try for a field goal.
Well, and this is what has hampered this Gator football team. This time, Noah Brindise goes back. He wants to go to his favorite receiver, but he's double and triple teamed, and you try and force the ball in, and Ainsley Battle is able to get in there because he has the inside route where Corey Chavis has the outside route. And good job by Quezzy of just stripping the ball out, keep it from being an interception.
Colin Cooper to try to make it a 6-0 ball game, and he fails. He just pulled it to the left, so the Gators twice first and goal, or rather first down inside the 15, twice inside the 10-yard line, and only 3 points to show for it.
Well, and that's what's been hampering this football team, is not being able to make the plays when necessary. You know, they were a hair away from having a touchdown, trying to get the ball to McGriff, but then again, you come back, a bad read by the quarterback, good blocking by the offensive line, but you know, here's another look at the kick, and he just flat out hooked it. I mean, it's like a golfer who comes off your foot going left. But getting back to what we were talking about, the offense is doing a better job of protecting the quarterback. Quarterback's still making bad decisions, Larry.
Jimmy Williams gets the carry, goes up the middle for about 5 yards. Johnny Rutledge on the stop for the Gators. Vanderbilt moved the chains twice in their opening possession. They've not picked up a first down since, as the Gator defense stiffened after those first two initial thrusts. Let's see if they can hold it where it is. 3-0 ball game, 13 minutes to play in the first half. Allen with plenty of time runs out of time. Down he goes. Johnny Rutledge coming in and applying pressure from the outside, registers his second quarterback sack. I guess you should say his second and a half quarterback sack. He had 1.5. Now 2.5 for Johnny. Just a breakdown by the defense. They're not able, I mean, the offensive fullback just not able to handle Johnny Rutledge. Paul Morgan
is not used to seeing linebackers blitzing like that, even though he's got a great group there to work with in practice. On third and 10, running room for Williams, but coming down is Ted Sims, and he takes it away, makes the tackle after a short gain of about four, and the punting festival continues as Vanderbilt goes three and out, and the Gator crowd makes the most noise it's made, except for perhaps the long pass to Quez Green as they applaud that defense. Well, defensively, they're doing the job against a very inept offense. This team is, for some strange reason, they get 5 yards on first down, second down, they go backwards. Gators with pretty good pressure. Webb with the kick, a low kick. Fair catch signal for and taken by Jacquez Green. And Florida will have pretty good field position at the 42-yard line. 34-yard kick and no return. A low-scoring game between two of the top defenses in the SEC. Florida leads by three. We'll be right back.
The best way to stay on top of everything.
On Sunshine.
11:40 to go in the first half. Florida, Vanderbilt, only 3 points between the two teams. This has been a game a choreographer would love. 1-2-3 kick, 1-2-3 kick. Let's go down to Steve Babbitt.
Yeah, thanks, Larry. Way too many punts, especially on this sideline here, on the Gator sideline. You know, when things are going bad, you try different things. You try different lineups. At the tight end position, you mentioned Taurus Ross getting the start today over Aaron Kenny and Dwight Edge, because the tight end position has been struggling as of late. Some new running backs in the game right now, Eugene McCaslin and Damon Bo Carroll. We'll see how Bo Carroll fits in right now, because, again, the Gators are looking to break a big play. That's one thing they've lacked as of late, some big play potential. On the defensive side, with Mike Harris not being able to play, look for Ron Grady. A couple of defensive series ago, he got in there in the nickelback situation. And Mike Harris is playing pretty well. That's a big loss, because Chico Brown didn't play that well against Georgia. In fact, Mike Harris had more snaps. So, again, this lineup keeps changing and changing. Not a set lineup for the Gators, and we're in game number nine.
Florida first down at the 42-yard line. The Vanderbilt defense got tired of waiting for the ball to be snapped, and Ryan Alves jumped. And, of course, once you jump, you immediately start pointing at the guy. Right? Doesn't matter.
Well, you hope the official will believe you rather than his eyes. So, when you look at this
dead ball, offsides on the defense, you had contact with the first down.
And what's so bad about it, Ryan Alves is a guy that's directly over the center. If he can't see the ball, nobody can.
And you're supposed to move on the ball.
Coach, he moved. He really did move, Coach. I know the film doesn't show it, but he moved. Quick pitch to the outside. Bo Carroll looking for a block. Gets one, but not the one he needed to spring it. Jamie Duncan runs him down, but that's about a 6-yard gain and a Florida first down for Bo Carroll out of Norristown, Pennsylvania, who's averaging almost 9 yards a carry.
And what he's trying to do is to try to get that fullback, Eugene McCaslin, to go ahead and make a block, run. I mean, you got me running like a plow horse, and I'm a thoroughbred. Get out of the way.
Fred Taylor checks in late for the Gators at tailback, and is told to play by Brindise. First down at the Vanderbilt 47. Taylor gets the ball. Taylor cuts it back into traffic, and it'll be dropped right there. Alfonso Harvey, number 92. Jay Stallworth, 89, in on the stop for Vandy after a 2-yard pickup.
Larry, the more and more I look at this defense, I know that the linebackers are the key factor for this football team, but that defensive line just do a good job of playing two-gap where they hit and read and react down the line of scrimmage. You know, they don't get a whole lot of penetration, but they do react and make it very tough for the running back to cut back against the grain.
Gators go with a four-wide receiver look here, along with a tight end. No running backs on second down and a long eight. There's Quez Green. He's got one man to beat. He beats him, but that gives Hall time to get there. Look at the pursuit for Carlton Hall. That's a big linebacker running about 20 yards to catch John Quez Green.
Well, if you're the leading tackle on a football team, it's because of talent and effort. And here we see tremendous effort by Hall as he starts to blitz. He's picked up by Zach Phillips. He sees the release of the football. Now watch him turn and run and get back into play as Quezzy beats Chavis, but Hall's right there to make the catch.
And Chavis did the right thing. If you're going to get beaten there, force him inside. Don't let him beat you to the outside. Third down for the Gators. They need to get almost to the 37-yard line. Brindise under pressure throws deep. Travis McGriff got it at the 20. Travis McGriff will score a touchdown.
And a super job by Noah Brindise, knowing he's going to get hit, that they don't have enough people to pick up the blitz. Holds on to it till the last minute and lets it go. Puts a lot of air under it, allowing Travis McGriff to run underneath as he beats Ainsley Battle for the touchdown. Beautiful throw, great catch and run by Travis McGriff. Super job by Noah Brindise. The senior knows he's going to get hit. He's getting pressure, stands in there, releases the football.
And now we were talking before the ball game. The pressure came from where Noah could see it coming. And if that happens, the quarterback's okay because he can time the throw.
Right. He can see to his right side. You usually try and take your offensive tackle, your best tackle, move him to the left side so that your blind side's covered. Now, by having the protection go left, he knows that the free blitzer is coming right.
Great execution by the Florida offense. They are in the end zone. 9:44 to play first half. It's a 10-point ball game. Now the Gator football team with some breathing room for the first time in a few ball games. A 10-0 advantage as Robbie Stevenson kicks off for the third time. This one will not go through the end zone, and Duke will begin to return at about the goal line. Alvin Duke running right side, doesn't get very far, diving to make the ankle top tackle. That's a walk-on, Matt McCown out of Ocala Forest. He and Jared McGrath were high school teammates a year ago. Now he makes a special team tackle for the Florida Gators.
Now watch this protection. This is the way you pass protect. You leave the outside guy when you know that you don't have enough guys. You let the outside guy go free. Quarterback has a split second more to throw the football as you see Travis McGriff sprinting into the end zone.
58-yard drive took a minute 56. The Gators up 10 and Vanderbilt back at its own 15. Allen after the pitch has a wide open tight end. And that'll be a first down pickup. Elliot Carson makes the catch and gets the ball up to the 28-yard line where he's run down by Javon Kurtz.
Good job of play action as they fake the pitch and tried to come out the backside, but the Gator defense was not fooled. Elliot is able to get open and make the catch, but Javon Kurtz was with him step for step. Good throw by Damian Allen.
That is the third first down of the ball game for the Vanderbilt offense, their first since their initial series. That picks up the noise. Five on the play clock. The Commodores get it off. There's the option to the outside. Not much running room. McGrath is hit by Tony George and spins forward for a couple of yards on the play. The two Gators are late getting up. We'll check on them momentarily. The Vanderbilt Commodores, 10 players from the state of Florida. Anthony Asma from Daytona Beach, Mainland. Among them, of course, we've seen a lot of Jared McGrath, the running back, the freshman from Ocala Forest. And they intend to continue to recruit the state of Florida. Both Gator players got up, shook it off, and they're still in the ballgame as Vanderbilt faces second down at the 30-yard line. Quick pitch to the outside. McGrath cuts it inside, but a host of Gator tacklers led by Johnny Rutledge there to make the play defensively. Chico Brown got in on the action as well.
It's called effort, Larry. That's what it's called because Johnny Rutledge gets upfield, turns the play in, gets cut. He gets cut, jumps back up, and is still in on the play. Now watch him get up and get back in on the play before McGrath could turn it up. Tremendous effort by Johnny Rutledge as he's cut by the fullback, gets right back up. You know, that makes the coach happy.
Also, when you see five of your 11 defenders in the picture when the play ends. Allen under pressure, flag is thrown. Allen runs around and he'll be sacked back at the 23-yard line. The umpire threw the flag, and 90% of the time, that's offensive holding. We'll see if this is the 10% exception. Nope, back block. Put him down low.
And realistically, that's exactly what this football team has been doing all day. You see these Gator football players getting up, grabbing their legs. And that's because this team is taught to cut them down, get them off their feet, create running room.
Block on the offense, penalty is declined, fourth down.
And I think this is called because Paul Morgan, as he goes to try and chop block Cohen, he's engaged, so you cannot hit a guy low when he's already engaged by another offender.
That is a dangerous thing to block a guy when he's engaged his weight on those legs. It's a bad kick. Jimmy Richardson was in the return for Florida, but instead he just watches that wobbler, and Joe Webb will get a nice number out of this, even though his punt only went about 15 yards in the air. It was a 38-yarder. The Gators back on offense with a 10-point lead. Carol Ross and her ninth-ranked Lady Gator basketball team will open the season Tuesday night, November 11th at 7 o'clock in the O'Connell Center against a team from the Baltic States. It's an exhibition to start off the season. Come on out to the O-Dome. For ticket information on Lady Gator basketball, be sure to call 352-375-GO-US. Florida goes on offense. They scored a touchdown their last possession. We'll see what the Gators can do here with three receivers split wide at the 37-yard line. Vanderbilt shows blitz on the inside with both Duncan and Hall. Now the Gators bring Aaron Kinney in tight. High pass up to get it. Nice play. Travis McGriff into the Vanderbilt territory at the Commodore 47-yard line. It's a first down. Let's get an update from Steve Babbitt.
Thanks, Larry. A couple injury updates. Mike Peterson, that knee a little bit tender, and he's a little bit tentative on it, so you might not see a lot of Mike Peterson out there today on the defensive side. You will not see any more Willie Rogers. He tested that knee out, a no-go for Willie Rogers with that right knee sprain.
That's tough for Willie. 50-year senior homecoming and injured and out for the day, but ideally he'll be back next week when the Gators play South Carolina on the road. Gators run the sprint draw. There's Bo Carroll, and he gets 2 or 3 yards before he's knocked off his pins by Carlton Hall yet again.
And these linebackers will make a lot of tackles, but you have to give the defensive line a lot of credit because they close down the hole and make it impossible for the back to make a hard cut as the linebacker fills.
Zach Zadalis into the ballgame for Florida, the redshirt freshman from Santa Fe High School in Alachua. Started against Auburn and Georgia. Did not start today, but he is back on the field on second down. Brindise throws the fade right side. Quez Green's got it at the 30 and out of bounds at the 26-yard line. Jaquez Green with a Florida first down. Another excellent throw by Noel Brindise as he just throws it high and outside. The only person that can catch this football is Jaquez Green. Three-step drop, gets rid of the football on timing. Perfect throw high and outside. Good job of catching the ball in his hands as you see Jaquez stretching out, catching it on the fingertips.
Well, since that drop, he's made a couple of tough catches.
Well, those are the ones that are the toughest. The ones where you're wide open and, you know, you start to think about what all the things you want to get accomplished.
Slant to the inside, off the fingertips of Green. That would have been six, but he couldn't pull it in as he had gotten inside Fred Vincent.
We've got a flag down, and looking at Noel Brindise, he signaled it's going to be against the Commodores, but that's one where he would like to have back as a quarterback. He'd like to put a little air on it because that one he sort of gunned it and didn't allow Quezzi a chance to get his head around and get two hands up to try and come down with the catch.
5 yards face mask on the defense, 5 yards from the previous spot, repeat first down.
That's a different penalty, 5 yard face mask on the defense, not on a running play.
Well, you've been beat out outside, you're worried about the fade, and then it's just a quick slant, and the ball gets there in such a hurry, Quezzi's not able to get both hands up, he can only get his left hand on it.
From the 21, Florida now, the first and five, you can play around with a play like this. Vanderbilt showed blitz, now they all back off. They give it to Bo Carroll. Carroll inside the 20, down to the 18. Jamie Duncan made the stop, but Bo Carroll picked up about three.
Another good job of that defensive line as the O-line comes off. Good job of blocking the point of attack, but those linebackers just float to the football. We see Jamie Duncan coming from his no linebacker slot to make the tackle.
Bo Carroll's been quiet in recent weeks, but he's much more active today. Three carries so far for 11 yards. And still in the ballgame on second down and a long two. And Vanderbilt jumps again. Ryan Alts for the second time is the culprit. And it should give Florida a first down inside the 15-yard line. And this has got to be driving Woody Woodhopper insane. When you see your defensive line continually pulled offside. And there's just no reason for it. You're just guessing, you know, and you cannot guess. You've got to look in and watch the football.
There you see Woody Woodenhofer. Good guy, good football coach. Can he get it done at Vandy as a head coach? A lot of people have tried and failed. First down at the 14, it was a four-yard mark off. Though Carroll can't get through. There was a hole. If he gets through, he's off to the races. But Jason Hill got a hand on him, brought him down for no gain. And Bo Carroll sees a hole as he tries to cut back, coming back out that left side. But another good job of fighting off the blocker and making the tackle by Jason Hill.
He'll give him about a half yard on the play, just shy of the 13-yard line. The Gators have three wide. Gators up 10-0, trying to build a little comfort zone for themselves in this contest. Noah Brindise has gone all the way. We expect to see Doug Johnson. Big rush. And there's Carroll. He could run for a month. Look at that. There is nobody to be found, and Bo Carroll picks up a touchdown as a receiver for the Florida Gators. It's his second TD as a receiver this year.
Well, I can tell you this here, Larry. In the stats, it will say Bo Carroll caught a touchdown pass. But what people need to know, look at the acting job by Noah Brindise, as he knows he's got Bo Carroll. He draws the defense to him, and he just lobs him out there and says, now, run on in, big boy. Super job by the quarterback. You know, we talked about in the telecast, the opening, about quarterback's decision, making good decisions, and what we're seeing with this fifth-year senior, quality decisions.
Colin Cooper, 2-for-2 on extra points, 1-for-2 on field goals. He has five of the Gators' 17 points, and there's Damon Bo Carroll. With that touchdown reception for the Florida Gators, Noah Brindise now with five TD passes, and the two this afternoon matching the total of touchdown passes for the Gators the last three games combined.
Just a super job of drawing the defense to him and then screening out to Bo Carroll on the outside, and there's just no Vanderbilt player in the vicinity.
Well, he could have run all the way through the locker room. I mean, that was about as open as it gets than Bo Carroll getting the score.
And you know what was really different about that? The Gators so many times go middle screen. This time they screen to the outside. There's no one there. It's a cakewalk to the end zone.
Zach Tiller, Wiley Rich got out there, but there was no one for them to block.
But that's good. You like that.
Coach, I didn't hit anybody, but I still get a plus for that play, right?
Those are the kind of drives you like to see. 62 yards, six plays, and moving it right down the field, putting points on the board.
And you have to like what Florida's done offensively against a very good Vanderbilt defense. Vandy is number one in the SEC in total defense, only 246 yards per ball game. The Gators number two, but Florida has put on almost 200 yards now in the first half.
And it's because they come out with a good game plan. They're mixing it up, they're running the football, they're screening it, they're throwing it downfield, and this defense really has no idea what to expect from this Gator offense.
There's the kick. It'll go 2-3 yards deep in the end zone. Duke had a teammate say, take a knee. He chose not to, and he'll get a couple of extra yards out to the 22, maybe the 23-yard line. And that's where Vanderbilt will go on first down. Sunshine Network brings you exciting NBA action Wednesday when Penny Hardaway and the Orlando Magic host the Sacramento Kings, who may or may not still have Mitch Richmond by then. Tip-off set for 7:30. Magic tonight will begin it at 7 o'clock, live on Sunshine Network. Be sure to check your listings because NBA territorial restrictions do apply. Vanderbilt has struggled offensively today. They run the option. There's some running room for Jimmy Williams. And he'll get ridden out of bounds at the 29-yard line by Elijah Williams. But a good pickup on first down, about 5 or 6 yards.
And this shows you what happens when the Gators prepare for the option, because they are forcing Damian Allen to pitch the football. They're not allowing him to turn it upfield and make big plays. They're forcing him to pitch it in a hurry, and that gives the defense a chance to flow out and make the tackle.
Jimmy Williams coming into this ball game, Vanderbilt's leading carrier with 401 yards. He has 24 today. on five carries. Allen fakes the draw on second down. Here comes Willie Cowens, and Willie Cowens got him at the 20-yard line. Willie Cowens, back-to-back outstanding game from that right defensive end.
Well, he's playing superbly. He refuses to be blocked as he's able each and every time to beat his man and get into the backfield. But that was a coverage sack. Good job by the secondary downfield, not getting Damian Allen anywhere to go with the football. He pulls it down, but he's not as swift as he thinks he is as Willie Cowens runs him down from behind.
Fourth quarterback sack for the Gator defense of Coach Bob Stoops. They lead the SEC, averaging almost five a game. Looks like they'll add to that average today. On third, a quarterback draw, and it is stuffed right there in the middle. Buck Gurley, the redshirt freshman from Tallahassee, Godby, read it all the way and made an outstanding play.
And I'll tell you, Rod Broadway has got to be real happy with that young man, because Damian Allen had a hole, but he was able to get a two-gap and read and react as he started to come up here. You see him fighting off the block, making the tackle, not allowing Damian Allen to run that quarterback draw again.
Well, the busiest man on the field, Joe Webb, the Vanderbilt punter, at it again. Decent pressure on him, gets a line drive kick that'll hit at the 43. Picked up on one hop by Jamie Richardson, and he runs it back to about the 41-yard line. 46 on the kick, we're getting five on the return. And the Gator offense, which has scored touchdowns on its last two possessions, will try to make it three in a row on this opportunity, starting off at the 41-yard line. 17-0 our score, 2:45 to play, so the Gators with a chance before halftime, plenty of time on the clock to try to do something. They also have all three of their timeouts.
Well, they've got plenty of time to go down and put more points on the board. So the key is staying patient, continuing to make good decisions. You can expect the Commodores to come after you with blitzes and et cetera, but by the same token, you got to continue to stay patient and continue to have fun.
Gators made a mistake. They've violated the substitution rule.
Have a substitution violation on the offense. 12 men on the field for longer than 3 seconds. First down.
When that 12th guy goes in, someone's got to come out in 3 seconds.
3 seconds. It takes me longer than that to run in or to run out. But by the same token, you know, that's in defense to try and help the defense so that you're not tricking them with who's going to be in on the snap of the ball.
And it's when inside that huddle, you know, once you get out, you can take your time sauntering over to the sideline, as I know you love to do.
I was one of those guys that ran hard all the time.
Carlton Hall is in the flat. Fred Taylor made a miss and goes forward back to the line of scrimmage. A lot of pursuit from Vanderbilt. Glenn Young, senior defensive end from Detroit, in on the play. So a whole lot of nothing on that play for Florida.
Well, this play never had a chance. It was a little slow developing. You know, Brindise does another good job of trying to look downfield, but there's no rush. I mean, if you don't have anybody rush, it's hard to screen the football because everybody's looking at the release of the football and reacting up.
So from second and 15, Taylor on the draw. He bounces it outside. But the Vanderbilt pursuit depth, he's got about 5 yards out of it. Anthony Jordan, that third Vanderbilt linebacker. I haven't called his name much. He's battling a sore knee. Sprained it a couple of weeks ago. Carlton Hall also got in on the play defensively.
You know, when you talk great defenses, they all have one thing in common, and that's guys that make plays, but even more so, great defensive team speed. And that's what we see here as we see the Commodores react and is able to chase Fred Taylor down before he's able to get outside.
Third and 11 from the 40-yard line. The Gators run the reverse. Quez Green's got five. He's got 10. He's got a first down. Jacquez inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. Don Gallardo made the stop for Vanderbilt.
Well, you know that the Gators eventually is going to come back with this. You know, Quezzy Green is as good as any running back when he's got the ball in his hands in the open field. But great blocking out front by number 19, Travis Taylor, giving Quezzy some room to run.
Deke Story out there at the end injured his left arm, or his it appeared his left or right arm, but he is out of the game. Ryan Taylor back in at left guard. Brindise, plenty of time throwing deep for Quez. Coverage is there. It's incomplete. Nice job by Raheem Batten, the free safety, to take away the deep throw.
And that's the first time in I guess this quarter that we've seen where Noah Brindise made up his mind prior to the snap. And here he throws in the coverage. They got double coverage on Quezzy.
And there's just no way to complete this football as we look at Raheem Battle back in good position.
Oh, it's second down for Florida inside the 40 of Vanderbilt. 1:11 to go in the first half. Florida with three timeouts remaining, leading 17-0, trying for more. Brindise makes the draw, looking down the middle, and he threw it behind Richardson. It's intercepted by Raheem Batten, and Batten takes it back to the 38-yard line. So Florida has a scoring opportunity go by the wayside as Brindise is picked off, and Vanderbilt gets the ball back with 1:01 to play.
Well, that's two times back-to-back where Noah Brindise makes a decision, makes up his mind. He can't be reading the coverage because he's throwing right into it. As Batten is sitting right there on the square end, and the ball is behind him, behind Richardson, and he's able to come up with the interception.
Let's see how Vanderbilt plays it. 1:01 and all three timeouts for the Commodores now. Gators had a good drive going, but could not get points out of it. They run the fullback inside. That's Paul Morgan, I believe, on the carry. Stopped by Dwayne Thomas.
And a good call by Vandy. I mean, you know, so many times you're noted for giving the ball to your tailback, you pop it into the fullback's belly. A lot of times defensive linemen will run right by him, but the Gators weren't fooled on that play.
And the Commodores will use one of their three timeouts with 44 seconds to play in the first half. The Gators in control will return to the Swamp in just a couple minutes. Homecoming at the University of Florida. The Gators up 17-0. The Vanderbilt has the ball late in the first half. Allen throws. McGrath dropped it, and then he got popped by Eli Williams. Let's get an update again from Steve Baddock. Steve?
Thanks, Barry. In this first half, I've seen number 90, Mike Moten, make a good play on Damon Allen. And earlier on, too, I saw Butt Gurley make a play. It's interesting. Ed Chester and Reggie McGrew, those are the guys who are supposed to be making all the plays for defensive tackle, but Mike Moten has had a tremendous senior year, and Buck Gurley, the redshirt freshman, he's a good one. Keep an eye on number 99.
All right, Steve, good point about Mike Moten, who has been quiet throughout his Florida career, but has not been quiet this year or this afternoon for this Florida defense. Third down for Vanderbilt. They'll run it. They won't get far. McGrath has dropped. The Gators will probably call timeout here to save themselves a little time to try to have a chance to make a play, and they do call time with 28 seconds remaining and give a tackle to Anthony Mitchell, a third-year sophomore out of Louisville, Mississippi.
And Anthony Mitchell is a young man that last year got a lot of playing time. We called his number quite often, stepped up to the challenge, and this year has not seen a lot of action, so it's good to see him get in there and make a tackle.
Mitchell, a kid with a lot of physical ability. Is that trouble gaining weight? You know, a lot of kids come in and they say, oh, when you put 20 pounds on him, you put 30 pounds on him, what a player will be. How kids have trouble putting that weight on?
Well, they should put him with me.
No, he needs to talk to me.
When you talk about gaining weight, I know how to do that. I've gained 30 pounds since I retired from football, so I've got that down pat, lad.
Hey, you get a look at what's happened for the Florida Gators this season, the setbacks to LSU and to Georgia, taking Florida all but out of the SEC race. Next week, we'll be in Columbia, South Carolina, and then the week after that, 2 weeks from today, right here for Florida State. Crowd will be a little more energized 2 weeks from today than they are this afternoon.
I would like to think so, but it's still good to see the Gator crowd, you know, sell out as usual, regardless of whether we're in the hunt for a national championship or not.
Head coach Steve Spurrier looks on as Vanderbilt gets set to punt. 26 seconds left. Decent rush, but they don't get to Webb. The ball will hit at the 30, run out of bounds, and not much Florida can do there. 19 seconds and 73 yards away from the end zone on that 33-yard punt from Joe Webb.
Well, Joe Webb came into this ball game being a pretty adequate kicker, but today he's not hit the ball well at all, even though the numbers might not show it. He's got some great bounces, but, you know, those have been some what we would call ugly kicks.
Yes. Well, Florida's just apparently going to take a knee and call it a half, and they do.
And that will send both teams to the locker room here at the Swamp, Ben Hill Griffin Stadium, Florida Field. The Gators on homecoming, trying to pick up win number 7 on the season, and senior quarterback Noah Brindise in his first start, a good first half of action. We'll be back with our halftime program after these words. You're watching Florida Gator football on Sunshine Network. The Florida Gators with a shutout at the half here at Ben Hill Griffin Stadium, Florida Field. The Gators leading the Vanderbilt Commodores by a score of 17-0 as Florida looks to bounce back from that loss to the Georgia Bulldogs 1 week ago. We welcome you back here to halftime, and along with Matt Moore, I'm Larry Vitale. Matt, this team, the game plan is pretty simple. It's all built around execution, and the Florida Gators have had pretty good execution the first half.
Execution, execution, execution. They're having fun. They're making plays. You've had some mishaps, but overall, what the Gators are doing offensively is making plays and enjoying themselves.
And the Gator defense came out here to try to set the tone against the Vanderbilt Commodores, and it was a record-breaking interception that set that tone.
Well, Fred Ware has become the all-time leading Gator as far as intercepting the football with his 15th of his career, and then turns around and does a great job of running with the football as he returns it 27 yards after the interception.
That interception returned by Fred Weary set the Florida Gators up for an early field goal and a 3-0 advantage. And then the Gator passing game finally got going.
And this is what the Gators have been looking for. The Commodores come with a blitz. Noah Brindise does a good job of taking that extra split second and then finding Travis McGriff for a 44-yard touchdown pass.
Brindise added a completion to Bo Carroll for a touchdown, but that Gator defense has been everywhere as well.
And let's give Willie Cohens a lot of credit because he's played superbly today as he comes up with an 8-yard sack of Damian Allen to give the Gators good field position.
Florida with a 17-0 lead late in the first half. They were driving again, and the one mistake of the first half for Noah Brindise.
And this is what has hurt the Gators doing that stretch where the quarterback throws in the coverage, throws it right to Raheem Batten as he's able to come up with the pick, but the Gators stood strong defensively after that.
And the numbers bear it out how strong the Gators have been defensively here in the first half.
Well, when you look at the numbers, you look at the 35 yards versus the 210, the passing yards, 162 yards, and the 9 first downs.
And, of course, big factors in that, 4 quarterback sacks for that Gator front defensive line. That's been a big part of the Gator success here in the first half as well. Now let's get an update from the field and head down to Steve Baddock. Steve?
As Coach Spurrier was heading off the field to the halftime locker room, I asked him about the first half, and two things he pointed out. He said, we sputtered in that first quarter, but Noah made some good throws in the second quarter and showed good patience. And I think that was the key. And Noah was very patient, let the plays develop, and did a good job of finding the wide receivers. That was a tremendous throw to Travis McGriff as an on-rushing guy was coming on to make a hit on Noah. He also mentioned about the defense, pitching the shutout. And obviously, that's very important as far as the defense playing with a lot of emotion, being very excited out there. You know, though, the key here in the second half is for the Gators to continue that because, again, they've got to show something to themselves as far as rebounding against Georgia. So I think this second half, they might even crank it up another notch.
There's Bob Stoops. Stoops troops the Gator defense, trying to keep the zero on the board. It would mean a lot to those guys, I'm sure, to get that shutout this afternoon, and they're in good shape for it. But the Gator offense will get to work first here to start off the third quarter.
And what you'd like to see that Gator offense continue to move the football and put points on the board because that puts the defense in great defensive situations where they know exactly what the offense has to do, which is put the ball in the air, and that's what Bobby Stoops would like to see, forcing this Vanderbilt offensive football team to throw the football, which they do not do well.
It's interesting. Florida came into this ball game planning to start Noah Brindise, his first career start, and then get to Doug Johnson, but Noah with 2 touchdowns and 1 interception in the first half. Doug Johnson's not had an opportunity yet.
Well, and that's strictly because what the Gators have done is taken care of the football, not made a lot of mental mistakes. It's, you know, you're looking at 1 turnover, and that was just 1 bad decision by Noah Brindise. Other than that, the Gators have played error-free.
The holdup in trying to start the third quarter, and they finally fixed it. There was 14:53 left on the clock, and so they had to get it reset. They have done so. And we're set for third quarter action here at Ben Hill Griffin Stadium, Florida Field, on the campus of the University of Florida. Wherever you're tuned in to Sunshine Network, we hope you're enjoying our coverage on an absolutely gorgeous November afternoon in the University City. Markham kicks off, deep to receive. Carroll 4 yards deep, will not try to bring it out. And the Gators will go on offense at the 20-yard line to begin action here in the third quarter. Noah Brindise, who came into this game with three touchdown passes on the year and in his career, has added a couple in the first half of this ball game, one to Bo Carroll and the other to Travis McGriff. You see the Gator offense in the first half, productive. They've only had a couple of three and outs. Did miss a field goal when they had a great scoring opportunity, first and goal, and then started off that first and goal with a penalty on the offense, delay of game, and ended up with the field goal opportunity that was missed. First play, running play to Fred Taylor, and Carlton Hall, who had a big first half, starts off the third quarter the same way.
Well, he stepped up into the gap, and on the snap of the ball, came across. Play never had a chance to develop because he got penetration early on and was able to grab Fred Taylor in the backfield, not allowing him to pick up any positive yardage. Just a straight-ahead running play to the right side, but Carlton Hall comes from the backside, makes the tackle. Loose ball, Taylor falls on it at the 10, and then is pounced on by Hall. They'll mark him closer to the 9-yard line, and that'll mark the Gators way back there with a third and 20 or 21 to go.
And there you see Fred Taylor saying, it's my fault. He's got to make that catch. The pitcher's right there. He took his eyes off the football, but wisely, he doesn't try to pick it up. He gets down on the football, not giving up a turnover.
So Florida with a third and very long situation to start off the third quarter of this ball game. Gators up 17-0. Let's see what Steve Spurrier elects to do on the third and long. They'll run a draw. Taylor trying to find some running room. Gets a little, not much. And he's wrapped up by Carlton Hall. We'll just go ahead and not mention him anymore. He's in on every play, so you'll know that part. We'll just mention the other guy.
Well, what happens is when you got a guy like Jamie Duncan, everybody says, hey, Larry, we got to stop Jamie Duncan from making the play. Then here comes Carlton Hall. Now he's the leader in tackling. Guy just does a good job of flowing to the football, reads the play. You've probably got two guys, as you can see, on Jamie Duncan. Here comes Hall from the backside making the tackle.
Riley Rich, Justin Blackshear both hit Duncan. Nobody put a hat on Hall, and as a result, just a short gain, about 8 yards on that play for Taylor. Stevenson to punt. Decent rush, but not too tough. Ball will be fielded at the 37-yard line, and John Exnitis is there to drop Alvin Duke after about a 7-yard return. 44 on the kick for Stevenson. And after a three and out by the Gator offense, Vanderbilt will have its first opportunity in the second half.
Well, John Exnitis is as good as they come. You know, he takes care of his responsibility, forces Duke back inside. Once he knows he's going back inside, he makes the tackle. Excellent play by John Exnitis.
Vanderbilt with just 35 yards in the first half, 10 on the ground net rushing against the number one rush defense in the nation. Jared McGrath, he's got about two. He's hit and dropped by Ted Sims. Teddy Sims really played a nice ball game. Just a redshirt freshman. He's himself coming off knee surgery for some cartilage damage earlier this year.
Yeah, a young man out of Belgrade that's been waiting his opportunity. You know, this Gator linebacking staff has been so strong and so much depth. You know, he was third team, not getting a chance to play. And here's his first opportunity. He's taking advantage.
Sims only had eight tackles coming into this ball game. I bet he has eight tackles today before the day is done. On second down, they fake the draw. Allen has to get rid of it in a hurry. Morgan cannot make the catch, and Tico Brown would have made it relatively irrelevant anyway.
And what we see now, you know, you talk about having fun. Tico Brown normally would be looking to intercept the football, but he's having fun. He wants to take somebody's head off as the ball's thrown to Paul Morgan, and he comes up and he has one thing on his mind. That's to hit Paul Morgan instead of trying to make the pick.
Allen has had very few opportunities to let the pass routes develop at all. He's had to throw it in a hurry.
Well, that's just the Gators getting penetration. They're trying to make things happen on Vanderbilt's side of the football, and today they're doing that.
McGrath in motion on third down. Allen with time, rushed out of the pocket, still on his feet, and he will be dragged down by Buck Gurley yet again. No sack for Buck Gurley because there's no loss on the play, but Gurley part of another aggressive rush from that Florida defense.
And it all starts with Willie Cohen getting pressure in the backfield. You know, he's just having a phenomenal day. The tackle has no chance of blocking him. He comes around, forces him out. There you see Tim Beauchamp and finally Buck Gurley coming up with the sack.
Ball came loose, but it ended up rolling out of bounds where Allen covered it. And fourth down, it'll be another punt, number 8 on the day for Joe West.
is a low wobbler, fielded at the 23-yard line, running right through traffic. About a 6 or 7 yard return for Jacquez Green. Matt Stewart makes the tackle, and the Gators will have the ball just inside the 30-yard line when we return to the swamp with more coverage on Sunshine.
Even though Dodge Ram is the bright red gold standard of pickup trucks, we're always improving things. We've made our available Magnum V8 even more powerful. We've improved the already world-class interior. In all, we've made 130 improvements to the Ram lineup since introduction, including this one, our new blow-through ventilation system. New Ram Quad Cab. The rules have changed.
You're moving coast to coast.
I didn't know America was so big.
It's big.
New AT&T Digital PCS. Digital clarity, caller ID, even messaging all in one.
Hurry up, moving man.
One low flat roaming rate throughout North America.
I think this trip's made us closer.
Yeah, but it's time to come in now.
Welcome to life on the world's most powerful network.
The best way to stay on top of everything going on inside the Gator athletic program is by subscribing to Gator Base, the only publication devoted to year-round Gator sports coverage. Each weekly edition includes in-depth analysis, scouting reports, player features, and exclusive recruiting news. Now you can get 32 issues, plus the Florida football and basketball yearbook. Just call 1-800-782-3216 to subscribe today. That's 1-800-782-3216. Don't wait. Get Gator Base.
Mitch Richmond and the Kings meet the Magic Wednesday at 7 on Sunshine.
Hi, I'm Shane Matthews. You're watching Sunshine Network, home of the 1996 national champion, Florida Gators.
Florida Gator football on Sunshine Network is brought to you in part by Toyota's quality line of cars and trucks, Toyota, every day. And by AT&T Wireless Services. It's all within your reach. AT&T. We are in the swamp in Gainesville, Ben Hill Griffin Stadium, where the Florida Gators, thanks to two touchdown passes from Noah Brindise, lead Vanderbilt 17-0, 12 minutes to go in the third quarter. Let's go back to Steve Babbitt.
Notice on the sideline that Damon Bo Carroll had a bandage above his lip and asked Mike Wasik what happened, and he said, got a cut lip pretty good. Nat, I thought those face masks were supposed to help those guys. I guess my hand could stick in there sometimes, huh?
Well, without a doubt, you've got to get a big face mask when you're a little guy, because big guys are hunting you out.
Too young to have cut himself shaving, so it had to happen during the first half. The Gators run it inside with Fred Taylor, and Fred picks up about 7 yards on the carry. There's Bo Carroll, caught a touchdown pass, also ran for 12 yards in the first half of this ball game.
I think you also got to talk to him. I saw Frank need to talk to him. You cannot lead with your feet.
Taylor running left side, has a little seam, cuts through it and gets the first down up to the 42, maybe the 43-yard line. Jamie Duncan on the stop of the Gators. Saddle up Fred Taylor for two carries and a first down.
Good blocking by that left side of the offensive line. Mo Collins, Ryan Kalick, and Wiley Rich coming off the football, getting movement. And then Fred Taylor just lowering his head, picking a hole and running through. Jamie Duncan coming in, but he's carried him for extra yardage.
Horace Ross also put a good block on Matt Stewart to clear him out of the way on that run. From the 42, inside again, and there's five more yards. Carlton Hall, along with Glenn Young, on the tackle for Vandy, but the Florida offensive line trying to assert itself early in the third quarter.
And you notice where they're running. They're running that left side, running behind Rich, Kalick, Collins, and Ross. Another good job of coming off the football, picking up positive yardage as Kalick is down.
That's Wiley Rich down on the field for Florida. That's Wiley, 50-year senior. He is And the guy in the middle all season long. Florida has planned on Corey Yarbrough to be the backup center. But Corey injured his ankle several weeks ago and has not been back yet. Both Zach Zabalas and Ryan Kalick have seen some action there, and I believe it's Kalick that will go to center as the Gators check Pat Browning into the lineup.
Well, and talking with Coach Jimmy Ray Stevens, they actually considered starting Ryan Kalick at the center position and decided that, you know, Wiley Rich was playing too good of football to take him completely out of the lineup.
Now Wiley down on the ground at the 45-yard line. A 50-year senior, played his high school ball right up the road at Santa Fe High School in Alachua, playing under John Carter. A number of Santa Fe Raiders have come on to play for the Florida Gators. Shea Showers, such a key defensive back on last year's Florida team. Mike Peterson on this current Gator roster, as well as Zach Zabalas. And Wiley will get some help coming off the field, and we'll check on his status in just a few minutes. Billy Donovan's Gator basketball team will play its final exhibition of the season Monday, November 10th at 7 o'clock against a team from Lithuania. And then Saturday, November 15th, it's the regular season opener against Nichols State at 7 o'clock. For ticket information on Gator basketball, call 352-375-GO-UF. And UF students, remember, you get in free with your Gator 1 card. So you're going to want to look into that as well. That looks like Vanderbilt jumped for the third time. And this time it's the linebackers that were coming on a blitz. Carlton Hall jumps early. Trying an inside blitz, see if they can rattle the new center, Ryan Kalick, in the middle of the offensive line.
Dead ball foul, offsides on the defense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
And that'll make it second and about a half yard.
And what the Gators are doing different this week, Larry, is that they're changing their snap count. They used to go on second down or on two. They're going on third and fourth count, and that's really throwing this Vanderbilt defense off balance.
Well, they marked off the penalty closer to 6 yards than five, and they may decide to measure. The Gators had the ball at about just shy of the 47. The ball is now well beyond the 47-yard line, and they're all having a little conversation right now about it.
I don't know if they're having a conversation about whether they should measure for the first down. I think they're having a conversation where the officials want to get control of this ball game. They don't want tempers to get out of hand. And they're showing a little sportsmanship. They all shake hands and they line up for the next play.
I'm sure some Florida players may have had something to say about Hall taking the shove at Brindise and knocking him down on the defensive offside. Second and very short, and they'll get the first down, but not much more than that. Mark it down close to the 46-yard line.
Well, you know, the tough part about the quarterback taking a hit like that when you jump offside and the defender is unabated to the quarterback, is that that's part of football. You know, you expect the quarterback to take some punishment, even though you don't like it. No, it's just part of football. You gave up 5 yards, so he had to take the hit. Here's another look at it, and, you know, he's coming all the way. There's no way for Hall to stop in his defense. You don't like to see that happen to your quarterback, but, you know, it's part of football.
Gators have a first and 10. Brindise changes the play. The play clock runs out, and it'll be first and 15. Visor came off, did not go flying, however.
Well, first down.
Those are the kind of penalties that really upset you, because you want to get the ball snapped, but Noah Brindise, I like what he did. He didn't have the proper protection. He saw the blitz coming. He wasn't able to check off, take the 5 yards. That's okay. We've got three downs to get a first down to pick up 15 yards.
Noah Brindise has gone all the way at quarterback for the Gators. First and 15 from the 48. They run the draw. Fred Taylor's got the penalty yardage and more as he gets all the way down to the 40. Late flag comes in, and a Vanderbilt defender, Stallworth, is applauding, so he thinks the guy blocking him might have been caught for holding. Stallworth and Mo Collins were over there around the 45-yard line. That's the way it's going to be.
But I don't know if Mo Collins is the guilty party and Stallworth is happy about the call, but whatever Mo Collins was doing to him, he was so far out of the picture, he had no chance of making a play.
Holding on the offense, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first down.
Move it all the way back to just beyond the 40-yard line for the Florida Gators. So it'll be first down and about 22, 23 yards to go. As the Gators go backwards after a first and 10 at the Vanderbilt 46. A delay of game penalty followed by a holding penalty. The Gators have not had many flags today, but they get them back-to-back here. Just the fourth penalty of the day. Gators set up the screen. A lot of Andy defenders are there, and it falls incomplete. Otherwise, it would have been about a 7 or 8 yard loss.
Well, that's a good no catch there by Fred Taylor, even though he's trying to catch the football, wanted to make something happen. Him not catching the football was a break for the Gators. Commodores came up, showed blitz. Just as they checked off and got into the screen play, they backed out of it. Good disguise by the Commodores as they are able to outguess the Gators and come out of the blitz. Thank you all for coming back to visit. So it's second and long. Taylor remains in the game for Florida, which has a tight end, three wide receivers on second and very long. They try the swing pass this time, and again, Glenn Young is right there defensively to disrupt it for Vanderbilt, and that's a loss of about another 5 or 6 yards as the Gators are getting closer and closer to Vanderbilt field goal range the way this possession is starting to turn out. Let's go back to the field and see what Steve's been up to. Steve?
Well, Larry, Nat Wiley Rich went into the locker room area. A left ankle problem, not quite sure what it is. He was looking pretty good, so they're going to reevaluate in the locker room and see if it's a sprain and tape it up and get him back out or what. But for Wiley Rich, one of the few guys in this team that has played a lot of plays offensively, been a key part, especially with that shotgun snap.
Gators with very few seniors on offense. Wiley Rich, Horace Ross, Noah Brindise, and Fred Taylor. That's it. On third and a long bus ride, the Gators pick up about 7 or 8 yards and will punt it back to the Vanderbilt Commodores as we get closer to the 8-minute mark to play here in the third quarter.
And that's just Steve Spurrier playing for field position. We'll get as many yards as we can, not throw it up for grabs. We've got the lead. Let's punt it and let our defense play football because our defense is pitching a shutout.
There you see the Florida head man closing in on career win number 100. Bob Stoops in his second year as the Gator defensive coordinator. Like to throw a zero up there. So far they have. Pretty good rush, but Stevenson gets it off to the 15-yard line. Alvin Duke runs into his blocker, Donovan, and then he'll get swarmed at about the 20-yard line. 41 on the kick, 3 on the return. Don Exnitis, as usual, down near the bottom of the pile.
And this might be the best hit of the day. As Donovan, Jason Donovan goes out and hits his own man, Stoops. Turning him around, send him the other way.
We'll return with more action of Florida and Vanderbilt right after this on Sunshine.
Now you can build your own library of official Gator video highlights. Start with number one for all, including Sugar Bowl and Celebration highlights, and the salute to Danny Werfel. Add Gators of the 90s, hosted by Steve Spurrier, or season highlight tape from 1985 through the present. You can even watch the Gators on CD-ROM or listen to the one to remember, featuring yours truly, Mick Hubert. Use any four items for only $69.95. Call 1-800-538-2666.
Athletic competition can be frightening, a dangerous place, totally and completely out of control. Here's a videotape journey into the terrifying side of athletic competition. It's a place competitors fear, where the rules of the game mean nothing. A brutally honest look at what can go wrong, digitally recorded and stretched to the breaking point. And right now, experience fear for only $14.95. This home run offer includes a second video for free. It's called Folly, a huge collection of hilarious bloopers, zany antics, and superstar sports friends. And remember, Folly is free when you order the first video, Fear. The two-tape set of Fear and Folly is not available in stores. For fastest delivery, use your credit card and call the toll-free number or send check or money order to the screen address. Fear and Folly is only $14.95. Your satisfaction is guaranteed. Order now.
Hi, I'm Johnny Church. You're watching Breakfast with the Gators on Sunshine Network.
This month, be thankful.
thankful for all the sports on Sunshine.
First, the big boys are back, and that's the straight turkey.
The Magic and Heat take the court with authority, and they're never short on the stuffing. Then, with Lightning and the Solar Bears, it's all gravy. You give them the biscuit, and they'll find a basket. And finally, the college kids ought to give thanks, because it's the volleyball and soccer conference finals. So be thankful for all the sports this November on Sunshine.
Lightning on Sunshine, the powers combined. Speed, distance travels divided by time travel. Force equals mass times acceleration. Lightning, a large-scale, high-tension electric discharge. Sun, 1 million to 4 million degrees. Lightning, impact. One-half the speed of light.
Tampa Bay lights up Phoenix, Tuesday at 9 on Sunshine.
Been a long day at the office for the Vanderbilt offense. Nothing on the board, only a few first downs scattered throughout the afternoon against this Gator defense. And Damian Allen gets out of traffic, still on his feet, gets close to the line of scrimmage. But I believe that Dwayne Thomas and Tim Beauchamp got him for, that's officially a loss of a yard. That'll be a quarterback sack. Gators are just getting great pressure from the defensive ends, and that's forcing Damian Allen to have to pull it down and start turning upfield. But as he starts to come upfield, there's nowhere to go because the linebackers are right there reacting to the run. Officially no loss on the play, so it'll be second and 10, no quarterback sack for the Gator defense. On the option, Allen pitches late, lots of running room. Jimmy Williams one step from breaking it before he is tackled by Dwayne Thomas. There was nothing but clean green ahead of him if he gets through. Fred Weary down on the ground for the Gators around the 32-yard line. And the success of this is the ability for Damian Allen to get outside before he's forced to pitch the football. And in the process, he's able to get it to Jimmy Williamson, turning upfield with no one in front of him. Fred Weary on there, looked like his left knee might or leg buckled under him while he was engaged with a block. Well, I think he actually got hit by one of the defenders as they come over to make the tackle. You'll see the knee of Thomas hits Fred Weary in the head, and you see his left knee as it hits the head here, Fred Weary, and that's what knocked Fred out for a moment.
Wow, that's a shot. Into the ballgame for Florida at the left corner position is Doc Pollard out of Bradenton, Manatee. Doc's not seen much playing time. See if Vanderbilt tries to pick on him. Three on the play clock, they get it off. Allen will keep. Allen will get about five. Javon Kearse makes the stop as Allen turned it upfield once again.
And it's amazing when you look at a team like Vanderbilt that, they're not very good at throwing the football, and whenever in the clutch, they will still run that option no matter how far back they are. That's their offense, and they're going to stick with it.
Damian Allen, 2 for 7, 25 and an interception, minus 16 on the ground. Vanderbilt quarterback has a net total offense of 9 yards today. That net's going to go up with that completion on the slant. He connects with Tavares Hogan. Hogan's dropped by Doc Pollard, but it's enough for about 10 yards and a Vanderbilt first down. Good solid throw on a three-step drop where he just goes out, finds the seam. Does a good job of stepping up, throwing the football. Tavares Kearse just missed getting his hand on it, as you see Tavares Hogan coming down with the catch, forcing Doc Pollard to make the tackle. Vanderbilt in Florida territory for the first time in a long time, and McGrath with running room still on his feet. He gets popped at the 38, very close to first down yardage, however. Looked like Javon Kearse might have taken the worst of that hit. Tony George came up and laid a hat on him.
Just excellent running by McGrath as he cuts back, and then he breaks the tackle, and then he really takes a blow as Tony George comes in, hits him high, as Javon Kearse hits him low.
And they'll measure for the first down to see if Jared McGrath picked up the 10 yards necessary.
to be the first time Vanderbilt has strung together three consecutive first downs, but they're going to be shy by a couple of inches. But it's second down, so they get two more shots in advancing it. So Florida comfortably in front, you could say, at 17-0, but Vanderbilt's the next team to score, and this game gets a whole lot more interesting.
And that's what happened last year, is that all of a sudden a couple key plays here and there, and Vanderbilt was back in the ballgame, and that's what we would not like to see here today. We'd like to see the Gators go ahead, pitch a shutout, especially after the embarrassing loss last week with Georgia, where Georgia was able to put up 37 points. So defensively, they would love to pitch a shutout today, Larry.
Well, good sign for the Florida Gators as Fred Weary returns to the lineup at the left corner spot. Let's see what Vandy does. Second and inches. They'll just sneak it and get that first down. So they go right up the gut, get the ball down to about the 37-yard line. Damian Allen has been the busiest ball carrier. He and McGrath now each with 12 carries. McGrath has 15 yards and Allen minus 12. Let's go back to Steve. Steve, what's up?
Thanks, Larry. First of all, I want to give you an update on Deke Story. Deke Story hurt his shoulder earlier. It's the same shoulder that's been giving him all problems. So his availability of the rest of the game in question. And on Fred Weary, you guys are right. Dwayne Thomas beat him in the head. And once he got all the cobwebs out, able to go back in, they might have asked Fred Weary, who's Florida's all-time career interception leader? And Fred might have said, it's me. That worked. He went back in.
They're going to throw it. Jimmy Williams, wide open receiver, and it's dropped. Right through the hands of Todd Yoder, a guaranteed touchdown for the Commodores and a big break for the Florida Gators. And the Gators did bite the cheese on that particular play. Tony George came up, Fred Weary came up, they both forgot to get deep. Perfect execution by Williams, but the problem is the receiver, Todd Yoder, has got to make this catch. He knows he's wide open, and what does he do? He tries to body catch it instead of catching it in his hands, and it goes right through the breadbasket. Sun might have bothered him a little bit, but oh, you can't let those get away. Allen under pressure, Kirsten Collins, he throws, and it's batted away. Nice job closing on the play by Tico Brown.
Tico Brown was able to make the play, but Damian Allen was under a lot of pressure and was fortunate enough to get rid of the football as Javon Kurtz was right there in his face.
This is what they call escapability?
Escapability or run for your life. Call it what you want. He sees Javon Kurtz right in his face and he's able to get rid of the football in the nick of time. And Tico Brown comes in, swats it away as the ball is intended for Elliott, the big tight end.
Well, third and long for Vanderbilt. The Commodores with their best scoring opportunity inside the Florida 40. Gator defense digging in, trying to keep that shutout going. Little jump pass wide open is the fullback, and Paul Morgan has it inside the Florida 25-yard line.
Just a little check over by the fullback. Fullback gets lost in the pass rush. No one picks him up coming out of the backfield. He circles over coming from the left side of your screen. Once he catches the football, you know that he's a fullback, or an H-back as they call him, because he goes north and south picking up the first down.
Now Vanderbilt really in scoring range at the 22. Damian Allen stripped of the ball. Willie Collins falls on it for the Gators.
Another big play by Tim Beauchamp as he strips it out.
Now they signal Vanderbilt ball. Willie Collins fell on it. If they're calling that down by contact, that will rank with the worst calls I've seen in a while. Wow. I didn't think this was close.
Well, let's take another look at it because the ball is definitely out.
Oh, boy, he got his pocket pick. Raminte Bindham.
Well, this is called the strongest man wins, and Willie Cohen was just robbed of a fumble recovery.
Oh, my goodness. I saw Willie on that ball. I thought he was starting to try to get up and run with it, and maybe he was. They fake the reverse. There, beautifully defensively, Eli Williams snuffs it out and drops the play for no gain.
And the good part about that is Eli Williams did the smart thing. If they're running in reverse, there's no way he can make the play on the other side. So he stays at home, stands his ground, and he's there to make the play. You know, when you first see this play, you start yelling, reverse, reverse. But as the cornerback on that side, there's no way you're going to make the play, so you've got to stay home, and that's what he does there.
Another third and long. The Gator defense gave up a third and long just a couple of plays ago. Allen under pressure, same thing. He goes to Morgan, and Morgan very close to the first down at the 13-yard line. Johnny Rutledge might have stopped him a half yard or so short. And that's just got to be a busted assignment because they're coming with the blitz, so someone has to be assigned to the fullback, and there's just no one there. And there we see Johnny Rutledge coming from the weak side to make the tackle after the catch. And Vanderbilt is going to talk it over as they are faced with fourth down and about a yard. Down around the Gator 13, the Commodores trailing 17-0. And so they figure they've got to get in the end zone when they get this close. They don't get many opportunities, Nat. They only average 5 points a game in SEC action.
And that's why it's so important they get some points. In their estimation is that they don't get down here very often, but if they're able to score a touchdown, they can start to put some pressure where if you settle for the field goal, the Gators still have a two-touchdown lead. There you see some happy Gator fans are celebrating homecoming.
Damian Allen's had a tough day throwing it, but this drive has been a good one. He's completed 3 out of 4 on this drive for 33 yards after being 2 for 7 for 25 up to this point.
But two of those have been really not tough throws. You know, just dumping it off to the fullback, and, you know, he's unaccounted for. Why, we do not know. But two of the big plays have been just dumping the ball off to Paul Morgan, the fullback, or the H-back, as they call him in their offense.
2:38 to play, third quarter. It's 17-0 Florida. It is fourth down for Vanderbilt. Big hole in the middle. Let's see if Allen tries to sneak it right through. Morgan in motion. They do the quick pitch. Nothing. Oh, McGrath got away from a tackle, and it's first and goal for Vanderbilt. Eli Williams had the first shot. Did not put a hat on him, and McGrath makes it first and goal, Commodores.
Well, the Gators were in the perfect defense. They knew the option was going to come to the backside, and they forced Damian Allen to pitch the football. That's what you want. But Eli Williams not able to make the tackle, so this is Vanderbilt out-executing the Gators on that particular play.
Let's see how the Commodores call it here down near the Gator goal line for the first time. It's been a very effective drive. McGrath up the middle, gets to the 5. Tico Brown fills the hole. Wayne Thomas helps finish him off. And again, up limping after the play is Ed Chester, and that has been his entire season story to this point. Ed Chester has not been 100%, I don't believe, for one moment of one ball game this year.
Well, it's been real tough. That left kneecap has been popping in and out on him, and, you know, to his credit, you know, he wants to be in there. He continues to come back and try and play. They've had arthroscopic surgery to try and correct some of the problems. But, you know, it's just tough for a big man when you weigh that much and you run as much as they do and you hit as much as they do for that knee to stand up under the pressure.
Chester goes out. Mike Moten checks back in for the Florida defense. Vanderbilt second and goal just outside the 5. Florida crowd, which has been rather passive, tries to pick up the energy level here. McGrath again, and he got to the line of scrimmage and maybe a foot again before Reggie McGrew buried him. It's third and goal.
Good job of that Gator defense, holding their ground, refusing to be pushed out of there. Center of that defensive line is just creating a pile and then reacting, fighting off the block, making the tackles. You see Reggie McGrew splitting two blockers and is able to get in on the tackle of McGrath.
Two wide receivers for Vanderbilt on third and goal. Option to the left. Allen keeps it inside the 2, inside the 1, but he's not in. He had nowhere to go with the option, turned into the traffic, and was able to spin down just inches shy of the end zone.
And that's just a good job by Damian Allen. Once the play was stopped, just turning back inside, and the Gators got cut off on the backside and gave him a little running room.
35 seconds left in the third quarter. The Commodores will use their second timeout of this drive. to talk over their fourth down play call. So we'll be back to see if the Gators can make a goal line stand or if Vanderbilt can get in the end zone when we return on Sunshine. Gator defensive coordinator Bob Stoops has given his defense the call what he expects Vanderbilt to try on fourth and goal. And they do not need much. Look at that. Maybe a couple, 3 inches. And this is a big play for the defense. This would be called coming up with a play when you need it to try and keep that shutout going. So they brought in Brian Gruber at the split receiver slot to get a little bit more beef for the Vanderbilt offense. And what the Gators got to do here is they've got to get low, and they've got to be able to push this offense back. All right, here we go. Fourth and goal. McGrath over the top, touchdown. That was too easy. McGrath goes in over the top, untouched, as he hurdled a Gator defender going in for the touchdown. Looks like Florida really loaded up on Damian Allen, expecting him to run with it.
Well, you would think that they would do something with Damian Allen because of his ability to run with the football and creating more options, but they just came straight ahead, giving the ball to McGrath with a lead block going up and over.
And so now we've got a possible 10-point ball game, and now we have a 10-point ball game on the extra point as the Vanderbilt Commodores, on a long scoring drive that included several third down conversions, a couple of fourth down conversions, the Commodores get in the end zone and close the gap to 10 against these Florida Gators. Well, that was an excellent drive, helped by the Gators not being able to come up. Like that was Tim Beauchamp that McGrath went up and over, but not being able to come up with the fumble when the ball was put on the ground. You know, they had their opportunity to stop him, but when you don't take a gift and you let it get away to come back to hunt, and that's exactly what happened. That was one of the stranger fumble recoveries we've ever seen as well. I mean, that ball was just laying there on the ground, and Willie Cohen looked like he got on his knees and he wanted to scoop it up and run. And just kind of waved at it with his left arm. And remember the name Raminte Bindum, because he's the offensive lineman who just reached in and plucked it out of it.
Reached in there and strong-armed it out. And, you know, what happens sometimes when the ball is laying open like that, it looks so easy that you refuse to just get down on the football. You're trying to pick it up and run with it, which you're already down because you're on your knee. So you need to just get on top of the football, make sure of the recovery.
Let's see how the Gator offense responds. They've been on the sideline a long time, and you know that Vanderbilt defense will be quite inspired. High short kick. It hits the ground. It's a free ball, and it's batted out of bounds by Bo Carroll at the 20 or 21-yard line.
Good heads-up play by Bo Carroll. When he saw that he was not going to be able to get there and field the football, it was bouncing. He jumped up and swatted it out of bounds, knowing that they would get the ball there.
Go back to Steve Babick for a report. Steve?
Well, Larry, you talked about Ed Chester, the story of his season, that bad knee. In fact, it's bothering him. He cannot go any further, so Ed Chester's done. Wiley Ricks, they put the boot on the ankle, the left ankle, to help support it. It's a sprained ankle. I think Wiley will be able to go out there and go back to being the center. Let's take a look on this offensive series.
All right, thanks a lot, Steve. Here's the key to the Vanderbilt drive, the fumble that was not recovered by the Gators.
Well, this is a big play because right here, you're on your knees, get down, get the football. Instead, he's trying to get up, and Bynum is able to reach in and take the ball away from him. If he gets down on the football, that's the easy recovery going the other way. Gators got the ball.
Instead, an 80-yard scoring drive for the Vanderbilt Commodores that ate up a lot of clock, kept the Gator offense on the sideline, and almost took the ball out of bounds. Let's see, they call illegal batting on the Gators for swatting at a loose ball, but Vanderbilt declined it.
Well, they declined it because if you penalize the Gators, you got to kick it over, and you kick it through the end zone, they're going to get it right there on the 20 anyway.
Let's see if the Florida offense can get something going. makes the draw on first down. Brindise looking deep, throws deep into double coverage. Quez Green makes an amazing catch. Quez still on his feet inside the 35-yard line. Three Commodores all around him, but Jacquez Green makes the play.
Well, that's just a tremendous individual effort by Jacquez Green, but once again, there was a poor decision by the quarterback throwing in the coverage. You've got three guys around Jacquez Green as he goes up and takes the ball from Corey Chavis, Raheem Batten, and I think it was Ainsley Battle. But this is just a great individual effort, as you see, super concentration on Jacquez Green's part as he goes up and catches the football between three defenders.
Gators run inside. There's a flag that'll be holding Fred Taylor down to the 21-yard line, but Florida will be flagged. It came from the umpire on that draw play, and will march the Gators back.
Well, they'll call this back, but that was a super run by Fred Taylor as he broke tackles for 10, 12 yards, but all for no avail.
The Gators have 277 yards of total offense as we reach the end of the third quarter.
That's a 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. We'll repeat first down, and we will extend the period.
Extend the period by one play, so we have one more play. One more play here in the third quarter. It'll be an untimed play for the Gator offense. They mark the ball at the 44, so it is almost exactly 10 yards. Meanwhile, the band continues to play We Are the Boys while the Gators line up for a play. They always play We Are the Boys at the end of the third quarter. This will be the first time it's had an encore performance. Oh, apparently the band director is not much to listen in on the official or whatever. So that is the first of what may be several renditions of We Are the Boys this afternoon. The band still thinks it's the end of the quarter. They're playing all kinds of tunes. Noah Brindise is going to burn a timeout because there's only 4 seconds left on the play clock. The Gator sideline did not understand they had one more snap this quarter, so a very confused situation here at the Swamp. I think a little Gator growl hangover going on, or what?
I don't know about Gator growl hangover, but a lot of confusion where, you know, the Gators were thinking the quarter was over, they were ready to go down and start the fourth quarter, and in the meantime, the clock starts, and everybody's over on the sideline figuring out what they're going to do with the fourth quarter, and the third quarter's not over yet.
And again, the coaching staff is questioning why there is an untimed snap here at the end of the quarter, why they wouldn't just mark the penalty and switch ends of the field. And that confusion on the Florida sideline, we heard the referee announce that there would be one untimed play left. And so whatever the case is, the Gators have first and 20 back at around the 44-yard line, an untimed play to come, and then it will be the end of the third quarter.
And I think in the Gators' defense is that they're busy making adjustments on the sidelines, and just because you make an announcement over the PA system instead of making sure that both sidelines are informed, it hurt the Gators that time.
Florida, three wide receivers to the right, one to the left. Tight end on the left side, four on the play clock. One, did they get it off? Just barely. Again, go just to Jacquez Green, and he is doubled up and pounded after about a 4 or 5 yard gain. There is an outside chance that's the final play of the third quarter. We're not certain, but what we're gonna do is we're gonna take a break. We'll come back and find out if it's the fourth quarter or not. A catchy tune. They're going to play it a couple times today here at the Swamp. Van Hill Griffin Stadium. The Gators are the second down, 15 to go at the Vanderbilt 39-yard line. Florida's lead is just 10. So they certainly feel like they need some more offense before this ball game's over. Noah Brindise has gone all the way for the Gators at quarterback. Vandy with a bunch of players in the box. The Gators pick them up. Brindise with a chance to go. Deep finds Travis McGriff. Travis can't pull it in. Fred Vinson was on him. Jamie Richardson looked like he got inside Chavis on the post, but they go to McGriff and it's incomplete. Let's go to Steve Babbitt. Steve? Okay, we're not able to hear Steve. We will try to check in with him again down on the field with James Jones. You know what happened is they used up the rest of the battery on that microphone singing We Are the Boys twice. We'll reload those guys and check in with them in a moment. Right now, the Gators with a key third down, third and long, early in the fourth quarter. Brindise, good protection, throws underneath to Rod Frazier, and the fullback is dropped at the 35-yard line, so that'll bring up fourth and long for the Florida Gators. And once again, we'll check in with the choir director, Steve Babbitt.
Larry, it's the old on-off button. Sometimes that gets you all the time. James, talk about the defensive play. Too bad Willie Cohen didn't come up with that fumble recovery, huh?
Well, exactly right, though. Willie had the ball right there in front of him. He tried to get up and run. What do you think is in the NFL? And they could have a shutout right now. They actually are having a great game so far. They only given up unofficial 118 total yards. So, I mean, if you look at the way they're playing great for Willie, he's got to just pounce on the ball and stop trying to get up and run with it.
All right, James. Larry, you got to coach up on that on-off button on the switch down here. It just got me.
I said, I know, excuse you, looking at it upside down, so I said no, so he wouldn't touch it.
Well, you know, they always told me that Steve Babbitt was a very educated man, and he'd know the difference between up and down. We're finding out that he does not.
Oh. Well, the Florida Gators will apparently punt it away on fourth down. Robbie Stevenson into the ballgame. Gators take a delay a game, and Vanderbilt will let him march it back those five. Stevenson, when he's had a chance for these pooch punts or coffin corner kicks, generally gets his kick of the day. He sails it through the end zone. Let's see if Robbie can nail one inside the 20 this time. Vanderbilt with 10 men on the line. That's good to do against the pooch kick because the guy usually is a little slower. There's a driving kick. Going to come down at the goal line and bounce on into the end zone. So it'll be a 41-yarder with no return. Vanderbilt down by 10, gets the ball at the 20-yard line to begin their first possession of the fourth quarter. Vanderbilt had 80 yards in that last drive, had only 38 up to that point. You see the numbers. Florida still outgaining the Commodores more than 3-1 this afternoon.
But the big thing is the third quarter, the Commodores were able to go down and put points on the board, and the Gators in the second half still have not put any points on the board.
Now the Florida defense will try to get that ball back quickly as the Commodores begin. Three-step drop and a slant, and then, boy, there are a lot of Gators in the line of fire, and Allen throws incomplete. And that's one of the risks that you run when you run a two-man route. You've got just your two wideouts coming out. You've got a slant route. Everybody's out there, and there's nothing there. But you've got to throw it because you really don't have any safety valve. Eli Williams stepped right into the line. If that had been a good pass, Eli had six. He was right in front of the intended receiver. On second down, Morgan goes in motion. Allen hit, driven back, and dropped. Javon Kearse gets the tackle, but it was Mike Moten who disrupted the play with great penetration.
Well, Mike Moten's used to getting penetration. You know, he is the ultimate pass rusher at the tackle position, but today he is the greatest tackle in the history of the Gators as far as getting penetration and making the play in the backfield because he's in his pass rush mode. He's not worried about run. He's just getting penetration, and look what I found. Here's the quarterback.
Another great effort by Mike Moten. Loss of two on that play. Third down and long. Vanderbilt still in the huddle with six on the play clock. So the Commodores will use up their final timeout with 13:05 to play in the fourth quarter. The Florida Gators trying to get back on the winning track, but the crowd is not exactly jumping up and down as we speak. Well, if you're high tech, if you're into cyberspace, you can keep up with the latest on the Florida Gators by visiting sunshinenetwork.com, your web source for Florida sports throughout the state. Again, that's www.sunshinenetwork.com. Sunshine Network, we play your game. I've not visited that. I need to do it.
I don't have access. You know, I'm sure one of those poor kids that went to school here, got a solid education, is working every day.
Poor kid. To try and...
Your watch is worth more than my house.
Don't tell me about poor kid.
It's a Timex.
Third and long for Vanderbilt. Commodores need two scores. The Gator defense needs to get the ball back. Three receivers will be out to the right. Allen, under pressure, gets away from Bullard, throws it up for grabs, tips it incomplete. Javon Kearse deflected it, but just not at the right angle for Deco Brown. Thaddeus Bullard really put a fierce rush on Damian Allen. Good pressure on Allen, forcing him to throw the ball up for grabs, and the Gators came very close to getting an INT. Good pressure, Thaddeus Bullard, Johnny Rutledge. Good job of making him throw off the back foot where he can't get anything on it. And another punting opportunity for Joe Webb. This is number 9, and it's a wobbler to the right side. It'll go out of bounds inside Vanderbilt territory. Now they'll mark it at the Florida 49-yard line. Let's take a look at Javon Kearse in coverage. We know him as a pass rusher, but this time he's in coverage. And he just does a good job of reading the quarterback. And he came very close to getting his hands on the football as it just ran by, right by it as Elijah Williams came across and got a hand on it.
Yeah, I thought Javon had deflected it. It was coming right at him, but it was Eli who got a hand in, deflected it away from Javon.
Well, you know, I've always said Javon Kearse could be the best athlete on that defense, but after watching that play, I'm not sure about that. Running up the middle, Fred Taylor picks up 7. Taylor, still under 50 yards on the ball game, came into this contest averaging right at 110 per game, but he's only managed 48 in 15 carries against this Vanderbilt defense.
But this is the number one defense in the SEC, and you can understand that. They've done a good job of mixing it up, a good balance of play, of running the football and throwing the football. And, you know, it's a lot of tough yards when you go up against a defense of this nature.
Right up the left side again, trying to get the first down. It's going to be very close, right around the 41-yard line of the Commodores. They need to measure.
And the Commodores just do a good job of getting a stalemate at the line of scrimmage and allowing those linebackers, that we see Jamie Duncan coming in to make the play. But what they want to do is just stalemate the blocker and allow the linebackers to come in and make the play. And that's why these linebackers lead the team in tackles as well as leading the SEC. When you've got two guys with 90-plus tackles, that says a lot about your defensive line.
John X. Snyder heading off the game. Johnny X has injured his knee, so he'll go into the locker room. There you see the Gators about 3 or 4 inches shy of a first down. It'll bring up 3rd and inches at the Vanderbilt 41-yard line. And this is a time when Steve Spurrier wants to see this offense execute a drive, get these last 41 yards, and maybe put this game a little bit closer to being out of reach.
And this is a time on 3rd and inches where you know that Steve is thinking, should I go for the first down or should I go up top and try and get the home run?
And, oh, I'm betting play action personally.
Well,
let's see what the Gators do. Brindise may sneak it. He does. I tell you, he didn't get very far, but he got the first down inside the 41-yard line.
And a lot of that will still largely depend on the spot, because what the Commodores did that time is they took both tackles and turned them inside to the center, and there was just nowhere for Brindise to go. And to his credit, he just rolled and tried to push with those legs to get as much as he could. He didn't get much.
Jason Smith on top of the pile with Noah, but the ball's at the 40. Florida has a first down as we go inside 11 and a half to play in the contest. Fred Taylor made one tackler miss, but didn't get very far, maybe 2 yards. Jamie Duncan drove him backwards. We saw John X. Nidus leaving on crutches. Steve Babbitt, what's the story?
Problem talking to Mike Wasik. They're going to take him inside and x-ray it, but when they put that kind of cast on there and have the crutches, you know it's not good. So an MCL injury for John X. Snyder.
Snyder has been an important guy in the Gator secondary. In fact, he became the nickel man in the secondary coverage package with Mike Harris unavailable today. And we may see more of Rod Grady, the redshirt freshman, Brindise with plenty of time hits Travis McGriff and gets the first down at the 28-yard line.
Another good job by that offensive line of pass protection, giving Noah Brindise plenty of time, big open lane to step up and deliver the ball to Travis McGriff. Good job. They come with a four-man rush. Good job of blocking. There you see Cheston Blackshear in your picture. Perfect angle for Noah Brindise to step up in the pocket and throw the football. Just super job of protecting the quarterback.
Travis McGriff had a touchdown catch earlier today, now 3 for 69 yards. The Gators were set up. Noah Brindise was looking around, and Zach Tiller started to rock backwards.
You're talking about one for the comedy film. This is a blooper film if I've ever seen one, where Zach Tiller realized that it was no way to stop that 319 pounds in motion, and he just falls flat on his back.
Oh. Zach, if you're watching it, it was Matt Moore doing all the chuckling.
It just goes to show you, when that weight gets going and it goes backwards, it's impossible to stop.
It is run a little inside, handoff out of the shotgun. Fred Taylor inside the 30, gets it down to the 26-yard line. He gets the penalty yardage and two or three more. Carlton Hall again on the tackle for Vander.
Well, these are very active linebackers, as once again we see Carlton Hall make the tackle, fights off the block, and is able to get upfield in front and bring Fred Taylor down before he's able to pick up more than the 7 yards that he did. A little draw action, good blocking by Rod Frazier, giving Fred some room to run.
Taylor again inside the 25, spins down to the 23-yard line. And it'll bring up third down and about four for this Florida Gator offense as we go near the 9-minute mark to play in the ballgame.
Well, as much as we've called Carlton Hall's number, you think he'd be getting a little tired here going into the fourth quarter as he comes up with another tackle, running from sideline to sideline, Mittler.
Officially, that's his ninth tackle of the ballgame.
I think they own him. Well, he's always around the football, that's for sure.
Out of Oklahoma, he's a senior, as is Jamie Duncan, Anthony Jordan, Stalwart, Young, Chavis, all seniors. Offside. Now, Collins moves after Harvey jumps, but it appeared Harvey made contact with Mo Collins first, and if that's the case, Florida will have a first down. Third down and four, a long four.
Dead ball foul. Offsides on the defense, 5-yard penalty. It will be a first down.
And that's strictly because they're in a blitz mode and everybody's stepping up. But what the Gators are doing is they're going on the long count instead of the short count, so their timing is off, and they're not able to control themselves and watch the football. They're trying to go on the snap count.
Let's see if Noah can get one into the end zone. He has two touchdown passes today. Vanderbilt with all 11 guys near the line of scrimmage. Brindise throws the fade route, incomplete. Richardson with Corey Chavis, stride for stride.
And I think that's one that Jamie Richardson really had a problem looking back into the sun, trying to make that catch, because he gets a step on him, and he's running the fade route. And as he's looking back in the sun, it's hard for him to pick up the ball. And as you can see, he only gets one arm out there, as Corey Chavis runs right into where the ball was coming down.
Davis with the header.
A little soccer action.
Well, got the SEC championship coming up at 1 o'clock. Same two teams, Florida and Vanderbilt, different athletes, hopefully. Brindise drops back, tries to throw a slant, and there's nobody slanting. Richardson broke off the route. Quez Green went to the outside. Noah Brindise went to the turf, and it's 3rd and 10.
Well, it looked like he was in trying to get rid of the ball. If he was going to throw the slant route, he was going to try and get it inside. But Richardson runs a hitch and not a slant. So I don't know if he was actually trying to get the ball to Richardson or trying to get it deep to Jacquez, but with the pressure, was not able to step up and throw the football.
Third down for the Gators. There you see the time, 8:20 to play. With good protection, he throws for Quez Green, and that's out of bounds. Jacquez did pull it in, but again, the defense forced him wide of the sideline. And it's fourth down with a 10-point lead, and the Gators will attempt their third field goal.
of the day. They're 1-for-2 so far.
And this is just the quarterback leading the receiver too far outside. As you see, Quincy goes up and tries to make the catch, but the ball is thrown out of bounds, and it's impossible for him to make the catch and come down with it.
So from a first and 10 at the 17, the Gators with three straight incompletions. And now Collins Cooper will try a field goal. 1-for-2 today, 5-for-8 on the year. Cooper right down the middle. But Vanderbilt remains within two scores with 8 minutes and 14 seconds to play in the fourth quarter. The homecoming crowd can't rest easy just yet. Florida's lead is 13. More coming up right here on Sunshine. Well, Florida has added a field goal. The Gators trying three field goals today. That's a little bit out of character for the Florida offense. Leading by 13. Still plenty of time to go in this ball game. Duke takes the line drive kick at the 1-yard line, comes up the right side, and he'll be spun to the ground and tackled. Rod Grady makes the play for the Florida Gators. A late flag came into the pile. We'll see what that was all about momentarily. And it'll be holding against Vanderbilt. Talked about the fade route. That was such a staple for this offense last year. Not as effective this year for the Florida football team. Matt, why is that?
And I think it's basically because the receivers, you know, they're not getting close enough to the defender before they go by him. So what it does, it allows the defensive back to turn and run with him. Where if you go right by him, you got an opportunity to get on top of him, and there's no room to close down the cushion the way we saw there where Corey Chavis was able to.
Corey Chavis with the header. We'll have headers in the SEC championship match. The women's soccer title is on the line as Florida tries to defend its championship against the Vanderbilt Commodores live right here on Sunshine Network at 1 o'clock. It's from the Persevered Soccer and Track Complex at the University of Florida. Vandy beat Florida earlier this year, 2-0. Damian Allen, a quarterback. The ball is just outside the 11-yard line, and the Commodores don't have a lot of time to play with. Morgan on a little cross-buck action. He's driving Johnny Rutledge, and finally Johnny gets some friends to put an end to the play. But Paul Morgan picks up about 4 or 5 yards, and three of those were after he and Johnny Rutledge linked up. Paul Morgan is a H-back, not a fullback, H-back that he's coming on a little misdirection, but does a good job of keeping his leg moving. And you know, when you're that short and that strong, it's just tough to bring you down. And Johnny Rutledge has to wait on his friends to give him a little help to get him down.
Clock continues to run inside 7.5 minutes to play. Vanderbilt needs 2 touchdowns.
Florida up by 13. They fake the draw. Allen under pressure, gets away from Cohen, steps up. He's got yardage up close to the 20-yard line. It'll be 3rd and about 1. Elijah Williams ends up helping make the tackle for the Florida defense.
And once again, Willie Cohen is in the backfield, putting pressure on Allen, forcing him to pull the ball down. And this time, once Willie forces him to pull the ball down, the difference is there's no one there as he forces him back up into the pocket, and it gives him room to run. As you see, Allen comes up, picks up 7-8 yards, giving him 3rd and short.
Now Vanderbilt, at this point, not calling it as if they've got a sense of urgency about things. They've used up almost a third of the time left in the contest on these first couple of plays. Allen on the keeper. Cohen drops him short of the first down. It'll be 4th down for Vanderbilt. They are out of timeouts. If they go for it, it really would be the game right there.
Well, this time, Allen decides he's going to try and keep it. He knows he has 3rd and short. And Cohen makes the play as he tries to cut back inside him. Cohen has enough presence to reach out and grab him and pull him down, forcing him to kick the ball away.
Woody Woodenhofer thought about it, decided to go ahead and punt. With 6 minutes clock running to play in the ball game, down by 2 touchdowns to the Florida Gators. Gators trying to make sure they don't jump offside. Several guys in the second wave were pulling linemen back off the line of scrimmage. Richardson lunges for it,
made the catch at the 45-yard line.
Oh,
that was an excellent catch, a very dangerous catch. You know, when you've got the lead, you've got a 13-point lead, if you can't make that catch, you've got to let that ball go. As you see him getting on it, he actually trapped the football and does a good job of rolling over and getting control. Let's go back down to Steve Babbitt for an update.
Larry, as you and Nat were talking about the receivers and that fade route, right on cue, Dwayne Dixon talking to Jamie Richardson, saying, Jamie, you've got to go up for that ball. You've got to go over the top and fight for that ball or cut inside. But if anything, you've got to go up for that ball. And that's been the theme this year with these guys. We saw that so many times last year with Ike Hilliard and Riddell Anthony. Those guys would just outfight the DB for the ball.
But to Richardson's credit, Larry, we've got to give them guys some credit. You know, they're young guys. Here's a sophomore just now getting a chance to play. You know, he doesn't have the seasoning that Ike Hilliard and Riddell Anthony had. You know, they knew that they had to get close to the defender and then get around him in phase, where you see the rookie mistake where these guys are fading too soon.
Gentlemen, our future rests on the success of this cookie.
Yes, CW, but what do we name it?
How about wafer races?
Twisto cookie!
I've got it! Chocolama!
What about you, Hurley?
Oreo. Hurley, you're a genius. Got milk.
Fellas, tonight we have with us a real winner.
Like Cosmos from Great Southern Wood.
That's right, that's right. Our wood has a lifetime guarantee, and it comes to you clean and straight. But that's our honored guest, Steve Spurrier. Steve doesn't know this yet, but Coach, we voted you in. Let's give him the official welcome. Hello, Steve!
So remember, if it doesn't say Osmos on the yellow tag, believe me, you don't want it.
Get ready for the three. Get ready for the full-court pressure. Get ready for high-flying Gator basketball. Coach Billy Donovan's Gators are ready to make some noise in the Southeastern Conference, and you won't want to miss a minute of the action. With the Gators Saver Ticket Plan, you can see every home game for only $56. For season ticket information, call 1-800-34-GATOR today. That's 1-800-34-GATOR for a season of thrills with Florida Gator basketball.
Lightning on sunshine, the powers combined.
Distance traveled divided by time travel. Force equals mass times acceleration. Lightning, a large-scale, high-tension electric discharge. Sun, 1 million to 4 million degrees.
Lightning, impact.
One-half the speed of light.
As the Gators try to pick up their 20th consecutive win in the Swamp. Fred Taylor's got five. Fred runs over a tackler, gets almost 10 yards. And a Vanderbilt defensive lineman, Alfonso Harvey, took out an official while he was at it.
Yeah, that's just called said, I'm going to hit somebody. And the pull umpire just happened to be in the way as Harvey was trying to get back and get into the play. As Fred Taylor does a good job of cutting back behind the guard and right at the right guard in the center, picking up 6-7 yards.
But Taylor now 69 yards on the day. Florida, a solid edge in rushing offense this afternoon. I think where the quarterback statue would be a whole lot closer. Run the draw again. Taylor's got the first down and more to the 42-yard line. And what we're finding now, being that there's a sense of urgency on the defense, they're starting to take sides. They're not playing the two gap, and that's giving the offensive line an easier task of just turning them the way that they want to go and trying to cut off the backside. As you see Fred Taylor coming right up the middle for big yardage. Gators with some youngsters in the offensive line. Pat Browning is in at one spot. You've also got Zach Zadalis in the ballgame. Cooper Carlisle playing. First down at the Vanderbilt 43 with 4.5 minutes to play in the contest. It remains the Fred Taylor show. He tried to break it inside, but Ainsley battles the strong safety build and dropped him after a 2-yard gain. Taylor came into this ballgame needing 116 to reach the 1,000-yard mark on the season, but it appears he will not get there as he checks out of the lineup and Bo Carroll checks in. There you see Bo. Carroll gets the call inside, tried to split. A little seam there, but couldn't do it as Harvey drops him, and it'll be third and long for the Gators. Bo Carroll has been watching Fred Taylor come out the back door, and that time he cut it back and felt that if he could get back to that hole over the right tackle position, he would have some running room, but Alfonso Harvey does a good job of fighting off the block of Zach Sebelius, able to keep him from getting into the hole. Gators using up a lot of clock in these plays here late in the ball game. 3 minutes, 18 seconds to play, clock running. This game appears to be pretty well in hand unless Florida makes a big mistake. Vanderbilt is offside again. Quez Green on the reverse. Gets outside the man and is finally dropped, and there's a late flag. And that might negate the offside as, well, unless there was a face mask. We'll have to check it out. But Florida trying to run out the clock here late in the fourth quarter, leading by 13 over the Vanderbilt Commodores. Matt, how much of a confidence boost does this offense get? They had a couple of touchdown tosses, but just hanging in the low 300s total offense line.
Well, I don't think this is going to be as big a confidence booster for the offense because, you know, you look at the 17 points.
Illegal motion on the offense. 5 yard face mask on the defense. Those penalties offset. We'll replay third down.
But when you look at the offense, they scored 17 points in the first half, have not been able to do anything here in the second half, and this Gator offense is not close to clicking it on all cylinders.
They've got South Carolina next week in Columbia. The Gamecocks are hanging around the 500 mark. They would love nothing better than spring an upset, maybe get into the bowl picture. That's a game Florida will have to face with a great deal of intensity, let alone the Florida State game at the end of the year. Third down, snap bounces to Brindise. He just throws a wobbler up there, and the Gator receiver is trampled. Corey Chavis ran over Jacquez Green. The ball fell about 5 or 6 yards away from both of them, and the crowd asks for a call that's not coming.
Well, that's a no call. I mean, when you throw the ball up to grabs like that, and it's underthrown, and of course, Brindise is being hit just as he releases the football. There's just no way in the officials' judgment that Quezzy could get back to the football if the ball is dribbled back and you see him get hit just as he releases the football by Anthony Jordan and Alfonso Harvey. This ball is uncatchable, and that's why there's just no call on the official's part.
Inside 3 minutes to play, 2:57 exactly, as Stevenson gets set to punt. The first Florida must take the obligatory delay game.
The thing that's always amazed me about this is when the defense accepts the penalty, giving the offense just what they're looking for, more room to work on the punt.
Let's see what Robbie Stevenson can do here. He's been unusually busy this afternoon. There's a wobbler. Fielded at the 8 yard line. Duke right up the middle, gets it to the 16, and there's a flag. Didn't have many flags in the first half, but it has been a hanky festival in the second half of this ballgame. Only a 36 yard kick, a 4 yard return. That's the flag against Vanderbilt. The Commodores will be down inside their 10 yard line. You would expect it to be holding for a push in the back.
Block in the back on the return team, half the distance to the goal, first down.
And so Commodores 2:47, down by 13. Let's take a look.
Well, it's a clean hit looking at the penalty, but he hits him from behind. The key is you've got to get your head here in the numbers, got to be able to get it inside the numbers, and that time he's not able to.
Allen runs the quarterback draw, picks up about 4 yards. Vanderbilt needs to score a touchdown in a hurry to have any chance in this ballgame. Only two touchdowns, so one big mistake by Florida defensively, and maybe kind of game.
But it's going to be kind of hard to score a touchdown in a hurry on a quarterback keeper,
yeah.
A quarterback draw. And that just shows you how unimaginative this Vandy offense is and why they have not scored a lot of points. Here you come with the draw again.
Now Florida will give them 4 yards on that play. They won't even reach midfield by the end of the contest. They're out of timeout. So Vanderbilt's got to score in a hurry. Now they've got a third down at the 17-yard line. Gators have Thad Bullard, Anthony Mitchell in at defensive end. Derek Chambers, Buck Gurley as defensive tackle. Florida getting some meaningful playing time for some young guys. On third down, each back goes in a little bit emotional on the option. There's Jimmy Williams. Big hole opens up. Williams across the 40 into Florida territory. Tico Brown runs him out of bounds at the 42-yard line. So Vanderbilt gets a big play off the option with 1:30 to play in the contest.
And, you know, you take out your two starting corners and you've got your second team corner there with Battle and Baker. And what do? They run the option on third down. And once the play gets wide, you got your second team in there. They don't play the option correctly. And what do you end up? A big game for Jimmy Williams.
It was a 40-yard run by Williams. He'll end up having a pretty good-looking rushing day thanks to that carry. They fake the draw. Allen looking deep, throws it deep down the middle, incomplete. Well, he started to throw it down the middle, and that thing started to slice on him. Ended up falling about 7-8 yards wide of his intended target.
Well, now we know why he was running the quarterback deep. But in seriousness, I think the ball must have slipped as it came off his hand. And probably was a good thing because the Gators were in good position as he was trying to throw the ball to Hogan going through the middle of the field.
Crowd is really thinned out. We see that at homecoming more than all the other games combined in terms of fans leaving the stadium pretty early. Allen looked one way, now the other, throws incomplete. A little bit of a bump there between Yoder and Baker, but the ball was overthrown about 7-8 yards again, and it's third down. 2 weeks from today, we'll be back here in the swamp on Sunshine Network in a whole different atmosphere. As the Florida State Seminoles come to town, the Gators will be seeking their 21st straight at home. One thing a win today does is keep Florida's streak alive. They've not lost consecutive games since 1992. At the end of the year, losing to Florida State and Alabama. Wide to the outside. Williams has room, gets outside. Weary still on his feet, has a first down and more inside the 30-yard line.
Well, Bobby Stoops put his quarterbacks, two starting quarters back in, Eli Williams and Fred Weary, and they were in perfect position. They came with a quick pitch, trying to get Jimmy Williams outside. Fred Worry comes up, has a chance to make the tackle, and he misses the tackle as Williams gives him the leg, then takes it away, and is able to pick up the first down.
Jimmy Williams with 94 yards rushing today. More than half of it on this drive. 55 seconds to play. Allen running the option, and down he goes. Mike Moten buries him after a very short gain, and that'll use up a lot of clock for Vanderbilt, which must score onside kick and score again. Florida leading by 13, trying to hold on in the last minute of the game.
And it's quite amazing that they have been able to move the ball from down inside their 20-yard line and have only thrown one ball this entire drive.
Allen looking for the fade, not there, and he's sacked again. Tim Beauchamp coming in from the left defensive end, and that might be the last play of the ball game as there's 15 seconds, the clock's running, and the Commodores have players all over the field. No timeouts left for Vanderbilt as they hustle to try to get one more snap off. And unless there's a defensive penalty, this is the last play of the ball game, and it's incomplete. Tico Brown, Fred Weary had a shot at it. Nobody got it. And the Florida Gators pick up career win number 100 for their head ball coach. 80 of those 100 here at the University of Florida in the decade of the 90s. He also posted 20 wins in three seasons at Duke University. So the Florida head coach with the victory, the Florida Gators win it by a score of 20-7. The Gators led 17-0 in the half. But the second half, neither team did much. Vanderbilt got seven. The Florida Gators managed three. And that is the full extent of the offense in the second half. Noah Brindise threw for a couple of touchdowns, connecting to Travis McGriff on a long throw and to Damon Carroll in the flat on a 13-yarder for the two scoring passes for Brindise. Other than that, the Gators 2 out of 3 field goals. And that was the extent of it. Vanderbilt had one long 80-yard scoring drive. That's been it. Now let's go down to the field. You see Steve Babbitt with head coach Steve Spurrier.
Thanks, Larry. Coach, a good second quarter for Noah, but overall, your thoughts on the game? I know it's a good win, though, first of all. Good to come back to the Swamp on a homecoming and get the victory.
Steve, we're into just trying to win a ball game, and we played about like we thought we had to. Vandy made one nice drive, went about 80 yards on us. But other than that, our defense pretty much contained him. But Noah did hit a couple passes there, hit a little screen, hit Travis McGriff on a nice play. But Vandy's got a good defense. Give him credit. They're tough to move it on.
Have you seen us improving offensively? I know in the second half, there's one drive. You didn't have many ball plays there in the third quarter. They had that long drive.
Well, we played a little sloppy like we usually do. We had some penalties every time we had a drive going. We're just not as great as maybe we were, or people thought we were early in the year. But we got to keep trying to win some ball games down the stretch here.
Okay, Coach, congratulations. The Gators victorious here on homecoming 20-7. Let's go back up to Larry Vitale.
All right, thanks a lot, Steve, and we'll return to the Swamp. Ben Hill Griffin Stadium with the final word here on Sunshine Network. The Gators pick up win number 7 over Vandy. Home of the Florida Gators, where the Gators get back on track with a victory over the Vanderbilt Commodores by a final score of 20-7. The Gator defense gets the job done. Fred Weary sets the school record with his 15th career interception. Two touchdown passes for Noah Brindise keys the Florida offense. Next week, the Gators travel to South Carolina to take on the Gamecocks. For our entire Sunshine Network crew, Steve Babbitt, Nat Moore, I'm Larry Vitale. We'll see you next week on Sunshine.